But enough of this palaver. Let's get the show on the road.
Sounds like a choo-choo train. The ONA Express is rolling into your town, Anytown, USA. Hi, everybody. How is everybody this morning? It's a rhetorical question. You don't have to answer as you're driving. If you're driving, text me.
Oh, that's dangerous.
Oh, that's very dangerous. Very dangerous indeed. Hi, everybody. Opie and Anthony program. We have, of course, the incomparable James Norton to my right. And today, Sam Roberts.
Yeah.
To my left. For those of you keeping tabs at home, drawing diagrams.
They have little baseball scorecards.
Yeah. It's like, oh, Sam's to the left today. Ooh.
Yeah.
Sam's usually in front of Anthony, but... Oh,
they have those
to the left.
Shitty little symbols that they put, like a
right.
circle and the slash. And
I don't know what that means.
I always thought
those guys at the baseball game with the fucking book and they're writing in their book when something happens is the dumbest fucking thing to do. But I think Travis used to do that, right? Did you?
Never.
You never did that?
No.
My dad.
But a lot of people still do.
I assumed it was a dicky thing, so you probably would have done it.
Fuck.
What the fuck? For your dumb Baltimore team.
Yeah.
Yeah.
A lot of people still do that.
Really?
Yeah. Especially,
why?
Especially like the...
Isn't there an app you could do? And just sit there with an iPad and go, oh, he got a K.
Baseball's a very old school sport.
There's a big giant scoreboard.
It's right in front of you.
It's right in front from whatever, wherever you're sitting, there's one right in front of you.
And why would you collect those stats as a fan? I could understand if you're announcing the game.
Yeah, announcers do it, you know, so that they can quickly go back and say, oh, yeah, you know.
And they have something to talk about. Sometimes they just want to talk about it.
Right.
But imagine. Some guy's just like, you know, sitting there.
Imagine sitting next to that fucking guy that's writing it down and be like, oh, you know, this is only the third time this has happened in the past 5 years.
Those are the same guys that, like, listen to the game on the radio while they're at the game.
Oh, you know,
right, with the one earphone in. Well, there's that whole sect of, like, super sports fan that has to talk like a sports radio dude.
They can't
all the time.
They're not sports casters.
No.
But they sit there as fans and just annoy anyone that's at the game with them.
You can't have a conversation with them. Like, they just start yelling.
Oh, that's annoying.
You know, I got to tell you something about this team you got to keep in mind when they're out there on the field and you're going,
shut up.
I'm right next to you. Why are you talking at me?
AB, see you later. That one's out of here.
Yeah.
Right. Great. Hi. Well, anyway, that's what's happening here today. Opie's out.
It was a weird medical thing. Well, he had to take care of it.
What happened?
He can't stop leaking pre-seminal fluid.
Jesus.
No. It's a really weird thing.
Wow.
It's the vein in the scrotum.
Right.
That's supposed to block the semen and the seminal fluid. His is like a reflux flap. And his just doesn't work properly, so he's always leaking pre-cum.
Like, so clear stuff is just constantly...
Non-stop. It's like a bubbling geyser of clear stuff that he just couldn't handle
anymore. Yeah, he's got to get that fucking taken care of.
His legs look shellacked.
That's got to be an issue with dehydration.
Oh, wow, right?
Yeah, it is. Well, that's why he's always drinking coffee and water.
Yeah.
But he was embarrassed to say it.
Coffee a diuretic?
I think so. It's not...
It's probably not the best thing to drink if you're leaking seminal fluid.
You're right, but he didn't know. He just kept drinking it, and he didn't understand.
That's different than the Seminoles, right?
Yes, much different.
Oh, okay.
Good. That was a good improv answer by me. I just answered literally. Yeah, spelled differently, technically.
Technically, if you look at the words.
Yeah, you're making a joke, and I'm giving you, well, technically one's a tribe.
Well, I got to say, the talk of Twitter was you two gentlemen yesterday on the after show interviewing the lovely Jenna Jameson.
Oh, people heard it?
I think so.
Oh.
I think some people heard that. I know I did on my drive home. Very hard to drive while staring at the radio, making the butthead face. Little difficult, but I managed.
Yeah.
The
butthead face.
What the hell did she say? Whoa, she sounds cool. Yeah, we all listened. I guess whoever wasn't listening or wasn't here, not many people were here. They could have watched the video that is up there.
It looks good, the video.
Sam Roberts has it. Not Sam, is that who you are?
Yes, that's who I am.
Not Sam on the YouTube.
Yeah.
You're the best.
It's also up on Facebook.
You're ready to smash
it's
me,
also
though.
Up on Facebook.
Yeah.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah, if you just search Jenna Jameson, Jim
right,
Morton,
right.
Sam she'll, Roberts, you'll find us.
Yeah, there's only one video with all three of us in there, and it's not the kind that we would prefer.
We were working on it, though.
Oh, I heard. As a listener, I was a basic listener on the way home, just like all you out there. Uh-huh. And I got to listen to this interview. Now, I knew there was a tad bit of an issue right when I heard, she's asleep in the green room.
Right.
Before she was even brought in, yeah. I audibly, alone in my vehicle, said, uh-oh. I literally, out loud, said, uh-oh.
2 minutes, because she was here early,
yeah.
And so we figured we'd start the show right away.
Sure.
And get her right in. But
and then there was like, where is she?
Right.
And somebody said, well, she's scheduled for 10:15. And it's like it was, and I looked at my clock, and I said, it is 10:15. Where's Jenna? Again, alone in my vehicle.
Right.
I'm chatting with the radio. And then I heard, she's asleep in the green room. Again, let me reiterate what I said. Uh-oh! And when she was then whisked in, and the conversation started, oh boy, did I know something was amiss.
Yeah, it seemed that she'd, she's woken up. And sometimes when you just wake up, you're a bit groggy.
Yeah. Groggy, yawny. You can't get your thoughts together.
Still had some of that morning drowsiness.
Sure, yeah. Sure. That's what I, assumed when I heard it. Wow. I was, and illegally so, I was driving and texting. I had to text my good pals, Jim Norton and Sam Roberts.
Oh, you did text me.
Because I was horrified at what I was hearing on the radio.
I didn't even see your text till after.
Believe me,
riveting.
Nothing special. I believe my text was something way out there that nobody would ask. Is she on drugs?
Right.
is that one. And Sam's text, I believe, was, holy shit, what a disaster. I think that was the one I sent to Sam Roberts. What happened? What was your guys' take on the whole thing?
Well, I had watched an interview with her the night before, like the most recent one I could find, and it was from several months ago. And she was, like, crying on Entertainment Tonight, and I was like,
wow.
I was like, that chick shouldn't be doing interviews.
She needs my dad. Call her pissy eyes and fucking faggot.
And then I saw on her Twitter, as I was researching,
wow.
I saw on her Twitter that, like, 2 days before, she'd just gone on this whole Twitter rampage about Tito Ortiz and custody of her kids, and she was posting screen grabs from her phone of text messages that weren't returned, of her begging to FaceTime with her kids.
Nothing worse than the online argument with a loved one.
But it was
never
one-sided.
Want that to happen. Yeah, yeah.
There was no back and forth.
Well, he's probably thinking, like, oh my God, my ex-wife is the biggest porn star ever, so people listen to her. It's not like she's just some fucking chick.
Yeah.
Everyone knows who she is.
Right.
And she's going after you on Twitter. It's like all this private shit coming out. That's awful.
That's terrible.
And so, but when she walked in, I go, this is 10 times worse than the interview that I watched last night saying she shouldn't be doing interviews.
And I saw on Fox News, they had she was doing one of the morning shows, and I saw a video clip somebody posted of them kind of walking her out of the studio. She's in her heels, and she was a little shaky on her feet, so that was before she even came here.
Yeah.
Oh, was that before us?
Yeah, Good Day. Yeah. She did Good Day New York, and that video's gone everywhere as of yesterday afternoon, because apparently she was supposed to do two long segments with them.
Oh.
And they canceled it. That's why she was here early.
Oh.
Because they pulled her segments
for a nap.
3 minutes of TV.
It's here early for
me. Even though that's a different show than ours, I'm like, why? To me, that was really interesting to listen to. Like, it's because she's been talking about it publicly.
Yeah.
Jimmy, it's Good Day New York, not Depressing Crying Day New York.
Right.
What's wrong with
but
you?
But that's where she's at. Like, it is what it is. Like, she's promoting something, but everyone knows. It's like she's a really well-known person.
Sure.
And this is what she's. It's not like you're going into her house with a camera and fucking, you know, sandbagging her or whatever. She's coming out for an interview.
But yeah,
Jenna Jameson whacked out. Live TV segment cut short over bizarre behavior on TMZ.
And the craziest thing about this, the Good Day New York thing, it's on TMZ, it's on all these places.
Yeah.
She's 10 times better on Good Day New York than
She was here. And the video's available on YouTube.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah, so she comes in, she sits down. As a listener, I'm hearing these long gaps of silence and sniffling and tears almost immediately. She got upset very quickly.
Yeah, and it was like letting it sit there and just be was, I didn't want to interfere with it. Like, honestly, it was, that's what was happening.
Right.
And,
right.
And why there's no need to cover it up and there's no need to rush through it. And there's no need to let it happen. It is what it is. It's, again, that was where she was at in the interview. And
I kind of liked on the video. When you're listening, you didn't catch this. On the video, you can see Jimmy's reaction to the whole thing. And it reminded me. Remember when Carson used to tell a self-deprecating joke and kind of look around like, uh-huh. That's what Jimmy looked like. He's just side to side looking like, okay, I could tell you were a tad uncomfortable with the situation.
Honestly, not as much as you think.
Really?
No, because again, I've seen that.
Yeah, yeah.
I felt bad for her. I felt really sad for her. Like, I felt very sad watching that. Like, yeah, and when you watch people on Twitter get so like, you know, oh fucking, you deserve to lose your kids, you porn whore. Like, it was in that moment you're just watching somebody who's having a fucking, for whatever reason, her own making, whatever you want to say. But it was just really sad to watch.
That's interesting, too, because I know you know her in some capacity. You worked with her at AVN.
Yeah.
And you've met her a couple of times. So I knew you weren't going to go after her. Yeah. And it would be silly to just go after some girl that's like
yeah, you
know, crying and stuff. But I know how you feel about the me thing. And that does seem to be kind of a little selfish. Like, I was getting this selfishness of her. Like, she does have kids. I don't know the backstory, so right. I could be completely off base here. But I was catching some selfishness going like, well, you got to get your shit together.
And there was the moment, too, where Jim said, he asked, is any of this stuff that you could be doing differently?
Yes.
And she says,
no.
No. Like, yeah. I don't need to change a thing.
And everybody at that point in their car alone probably said, oh, boy.
Right.
Oh, boy. She's fucked up.
Yeah, sometimes, you know, again, I can't say she was, I don't know. I just, you got to give the person the opportunity to say, yeah, I should be doing this or that differently.
Right.
But I just felt sad for her. It was like, it's hard to watch someone that. Because it wasn't coming from a place of, it was just, she's a mother, and maybe she, whatever happened with Tito and the kids, I don't even know.
Right.
But when you just watch somebody crying because they can't see their kids, even if it's their own making, it's still hard to watch.
Now, what is the story with her and this guy? It's not Tito that she's in this battle with, right?
Tito Ortiz.
It is, yeah.
It is with the kids?
Yes, Tito Ortiz has those kids.
All right, look, I didn't even know that. I thought it was some other dude.
No, it's Tito. Although,
holy fuck.
Although Ron and Fez started and Ron Bennington came on and said, he and Jenna are working out their differences. But he's got the kids in there safe.
Oh, that's hilarious.
Yeah, no, that whole thing. Tito Ortiz has the kids and is in the house and won't let her in. And
are they kids with him?
Yes.
Fuck.
Were you there? I thought it was some
other guy.
No, Sam, we saw them together when we were in Comic Con.
No, at the UFC Expo.
UFC event. Oh. And Tito was being inducted into the Hall of Fame. And
Hall of Shame?
That's right.
Well, the UFC Hall of Fame.
Oh.
And she and Jenna was with him, and I've seen them together a few times at UFC events.
Oh, see, I didn't know it was
Yeah, it was Tito Ortiz.
It was him. I thought it was like some guy before Tito or something.
I guess we
wow. Okay.
Probably could have made that a little clearer, but it was weird.
We assume
to,
everybody knew it.
And it was weird to tell the story.
I was wearing a UFC shirt.
Oh my God, you were wearing? Yes, you were.
Dude, I wasn't even. It really, literally was. I wasn't fucking.
Should have a big Tito shirt on. Hey.
I wasn't doing it on purpose.
Oh man,
I doubt she even noticed.
Maybe.
Well,
not,
probably
I
not.
I was like, oh my God.
She probably saw like some blurry writing.
But
something.
There were a couple moments where. It's like when she first walked in and started talking, Jim and I kind of gave each other this look like, all right, here we go with something. And then the second one, I think the look of the people thought Jim was uncomfortable.
Yeah.
We were both pretty surprised that she broke down within
it was,
5 minutes of
it
being
was
here.
Really quickly.
Yeah.
She and to sit there and listen as she's trying to pitch this sexy book.
Yeah.
As she's
yeah.
just weeping and conveying these depressing stories of losing your children. It's like, wow, I had my dick out and I'm just jacking as I'm driving. This was so hot.
And you got to wonder, like, who are the people around her?
Yeah.
They're like, Jenna, we got to get you out. We got to get you doing interviews. Because at the end of the day, she it's not like we found out she was a damaged person and tried to get her in.
All right.
She asked to come here or somebody yes. asked on her behalf. Can she please come in? Okay, we'll talk to her.
Yeah, yeah, you didn't go knocking on her door or
like,
anything
like
that.
Who are the people that are carting her around and putting her in
I don't
in
know.
It won't hurt sales, though.
Shit.
It won't hurt sales.
No, no, it'll do great for sales.
Live appearances, yeah. People will go just to see her, and even though she's depressed or she's having a hard time, people are talking yeah. about Jenna Jameson today. Doesn't matter.
At one point, yeah. When she did start crying and Jimmy brought it back to the book, I thought a publicist
no.
was fucking stink-eyeing you.
No, I did that, and I knew when I was doing that, I'm like, I wasn't like, I wasn't uncomfortable with her crying.
Right.
It was like, I didn't know what else to do in that moment. Like, like I didn't want to be...
Barbara Walters.
Nah, but there's a weird line between,
yeah.
I don't want to, look, she's breaking down and having a hard time. But I don't want to be like, ooh, good.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, hey, she should promote this. Just please. I knew she was still going to, you know.
Yeah, yeah. You were still going to get.
She had just gotten there. We could talk about the book for a little bit before we get back here.
And I also was afraid they might pull her.
Right, right.
There was a part of me thinking like.
Was a publicist here with her?
Yeah, but they were fine.
Okay.
They were in the other room.
I was afraid that there was going to be that moment where
we
got to go. We got to go now. Like,
and you know, if you talk about the book, that in just a matter of minutes, the despicable Sam Roberts will bring it right back to tears.
I didn't do anything despicable.
He was listening going, oh, you son of a bitch.
I asked questions that were
loved it.
Legitimate and pertained to the conversation. And
you needn't make an excuse. Right. I was going, yeah, I was cheering for Sam Roberts.
I thought Sam was fair, though. I didn't think you were a fucking exploitive or shitty.
No, he was, but he brought it right back to the tears at one point.
Well, that was also the real thing of like,
of course.
If we had just sat there and talked about the book for the
what
next 25 minutes, it would have been, what is this?
What
it was good to get into for a minute, and you got to plug what they're there for, but there really wasn't much to say because it was fiction. It's not like it's real life.
And you can't make your business, your private, you can't. Go out of your way to make your private business public, and then expect people not to talk about it.
They got to talk about it.
It's not like we had to research and found out these secrets. It's like I was looking at your Twitter feed.
Yeah.
How did she look, by the way? Did she look weathered? Did she look
okay,
a little haggard?
Did you see my picture?
I mean, I know she looked okay, but did she look her age? Did she look older? Did she look like a lot of work done? Did she look depressed? Like people get that look.
Well, yeah.
She looked better than she has.
I've heard she looked better than she sounded from a lot of people.
Yeah.
Oh,
and
okay.
She knows how to pose for pictures.
She
wow.
fucking
yeah,
knows.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. She looks good in that pic.
She looks good.
She's still not... I mean, she used to be like the hottest chick ever.
And
I tweeted pictures of her early in her career yesterday.
Yeah.
Stunning.
Yeah.
Fucking beautiful. And, man, that porn industry will... it's like a meat grinder.
But she did get out on top. I mean, again, with Club Jenna, and she came out. Again, seeing how they treat her at AVN, and this is in 2004, January of 04.
She's royalty!
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
And, I mean, that's it was in fucking full swing, the expo.
Right.
There was thousands and thousands and thousands of people there, and she was the fucking queen bee, man.
Belle of the ball.
Yeah. Jenna is royalty in that world.
Yeah, yeah.
And, but everywhere. It's not just all in porn. Anywhere she goes, she's Jenna Jameson. So
yeah,
she,
yeah.
You know, she came from a place of being quite on top.
And it really seems like she let herself fall apart after she was well out, like years after she was out of porn.
That is odd. She did very well for herself out of porn. Wasn't she? She had the website, right?
Yeah, Club Jenna. Yeah.
Club Jenna, and she was selling like other people's porn, yeah. other people's work, whatever the fuck you want to call it.
She became a producer. And
so she's
company.
Making a lot of money. Now, what happened? Did Tito get her shit?
No, they sold Club Jenna to Playboy.
Oh,
Playboy bought Club Jenna and she kept Jenna and her ex-husband on as, like, executives.
What year did that happen? I didn't know that.
That was...
Her other ex-husband. Her
ex's name is Jay. He was a performer named Justin Silver.
Right.
And his real name was Jay, like, Cardenia or something. Yeah. And
you doesn't have to call him Jay.
Yeah.
Oh, you could call him Ray.
You could just call him Lucky Motherfucker. But he was a guy who was very... You could tell he was a bright, savvy business guy. He wasn't some dumb... dealing because he was the one who kind of, you know, oversaw everything they were doing back then. And you knew he was a guy who knew what he was doing.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, okay. So he probably, in the divorce or something, he wound up getting the lion's share of the goods?
Or she spent hers. I don't know.
Maybe she spent her. Oh, boy.
I've heard there are rumors that he took a lot in the divorce.
Wow.
Like he walked away with a lot of the rights to things.
It's not like he was getting a fat cock up his ass.
That's right.
Well, but he was in charge of her. And he did films with her, and, you know, he was...
Well, after they got married, he was the only one that shot with her.
The only guy.
That's, he changed his... He had an on-screen name, and
then... Oh.
Justin Silver, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah.
So she's left now without really an income, aside from, you know, book or appearances that she does.
Right.
And without her kids, with no fucking man in her life... depressed
and coming from a place like we said of being very much a royalty
you're on top
and then it's just like it really made me sad for I understand all about people doing their own shit and making their own
brand, uh-huh.
I get it, but it's still hard to watch because she's always been
she made her own bed, now roll over and take a big dick in the ass in it.
But it was just having had a few experiences, not many with her, but she was always so nice to me and I could vulture somebody.
That was fine. Well, you had Sam Roberts.
I didn't even think Sam did.
Fucking
Sam
circling above.
Sam's a horrible person. But
Nancy Grace Roberts was
he asked smart questions though. I thought he asked really smart questions.
No, he did.
Even though he's garbage as a person.
Complete trash.
But you also, you look back, and I was YouTubing her yesterday.
Yeah, looks good.
And she did, interviews with Bill O'Reilly, and there are all these interviews with her.
Right,
and she's so on the ball and there and present and has shit to say and has her shit together.
Are you saying she didn't respect the after show to come in sober and coherent?
I don't know if you heard the interview, but... She's been sober for 7 years.
I did hear that part. And I did hear Sam comment later about where she was living and if it was good for her career and her sobriety. How you said that with a straight face, I'll never know.
You're trying to get it out of her.
Jim, I noticed hard you too
to...
were commenting when you said, is there anything that you would do differently? Is there anything maybe that you could do? And you did ask her about some type of drug or alcohol use, and she said, well, I have a couple of beers or something like that.
Oh, so I said, you're totally sober.
Right.
She said she was sober for 7 years, and I think that listening, we felt that that's kind of hard to...
Oh, yeah, because I said alcohol and pills, too.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
It's like, let's...
I think
pills, right.
Yeah. Some people do think that prescription medication is sober. Like, sure. you're not out getting coke, you're not boozing it up like crazy, but you'll pop enough Xannies or fucking, you know, Vicodins or something like that, and you're still sober, right?
Yeah.
Which I don't think that counts.
But people got really, it was funny, reading Twitter after, people would think, hey, man, you shouldn't have your kids, or I side with Tito is one thing.
Uh-huh.
But listening to some of the really nasty people.
Yes.
And it was like, why would you be so, what did she do that you're that nasty to her?
Uh-huh.
And it's like, you know, you'd fuck it. You'd kill the woman you're married to fuck her.
Yeah.
Like, you don't genuinely feel that way. There's like this really weird thing. Like, well, you did, you fuck you, you deserve it, you bitch. Like,
yeah, I don't know where that comes in with people.
I think that's them yelling at every girl that's ever turned them down. You know what I mean? Every girl they didn't have a shot with. Like, to see something bad happen to the pretty girl.
I think you're right. Yeah,
a lot of the guys that had a rough time in high school are pretty happy about that.
Gotta be honest. When you go to Facebook and you do see maybe a girl that you found attractive, that you wanted in high school, and she turns out to be a fat slob, her life is falling apart. A little chuckle.
Well, she survived that whale well fire, and the only thing that's left intact are her eyelashes.
There is something about that where you do kind of, you do go, oh, good.
Yeah.
What a horrible thing. What a terrible fucking species we are to even want to see that.
But then it goes a step further when you're now trying to see bad happen to female celebrities, to any woman who's ever been attractive.
Right, right.
And that's a whole other level of...
It's so easy now with Twitter and whatnot because, you know, I guess you used to have to write a letter. You fucking whore, I'm glad that...
You think people wrote those letters?
There are times, I bet they did, somebody had to. There are times where you go to post something on Twitter, and halfway through writing it, you're like, eh, fuck this.
And we want
to hit cancel. And for how quickly and easily you can post something, it's amazing that there is still some kind of filter. But imagine if you had to write a letter and mail it. There's so many steps and so much time that has to go by. You could really assess what you're doing and kind of rip it up and say, fuck it. But with Twitter, it's so easy to just post hate and fucking drivel or whatever. Very quickly.
You're not writing it out and then reading it again in the morning before you drop it in the mailbox?
Yeah. You physically have to fucking find a mailbox, put a stamp on it, find the address you got to send it to. Now it's just ding, 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 you're a whore.
It's instantaneous.
Yeah. So I was reading a lot of the tweets that were coming in, and there was a lot of fuck you. You know, she deserves what she got. The kids are much better off without her, things like that. And... You know, with if you filter out the just hatred of a guy that didn't get laid in school, some of them kind of made sense. Because could you imagine her in that condition with children? It's probably not the safest environment.
Again, I don't know Tito that well, just from a few interactions.
Well, he's just putting them in fucking arm bars. It's not like, you know, it's kind of funny.
But I don't,
little four-year-old in an arm bar tapping daddy.
I don't know what he's like. I don't know. I really don't know. I don't think that because she's like she's kind of blaming the whole thing on him. I think every there's always two fucking people who choose to be involved, and usually both contribute.
You can't know what he's doing, and you can't know exactly what the situation was. But what you can know is, I probably wouldn't leave my children with the woman I talked to yesterday.
Right. There you go. That's kind of what I took away from it. When she's talking about she hasn't seen her kids and stuff, I don't think it's the courts, you know, the being mean. I'm sure Tito's being vindictive because that's what you do as a ex-husband with a wife that's like that. Because there were certain points that I was listening and I was having fucking flashbacks. Like, oh, brother. I would not want to be married to that. And then I'm like, oh, fuck, I was. Shit. So he probably isn't the most pleasant guy with her, just based on if she's like that. Why would you want to release your children to a woman that's that fucked up? Let's be honest.
Yeah, she sounded a little bit out of it. And meaning, like I've seen more fucked up people than that. Like, you know, just being diplomatic.
Yeah.
I've seen a lot worse.
Being diplomatic.
She just sounded, again, it's hard to say. It sounded to me like somebody who was either hungover or who is on a prescription.
Yeah.
And again, the pills affect you so fucking
weirdly.
That was
definitely prescription medication.
It sounded like it.
Yeah.
But, and you've seen a lot more fucked up people, but never on a book tour.
Just probably brought not, around.
Yeah, never in a radio studio brought in.
You would think her people would be like, all right, Jenna, we're starting our day of press. I'll come to your room or whatever and come and get you. And then the second the door opens, you go, yeah, we're canceling everything we have today. You're fucked up.
No, her people are like, we'll just catch a 10-minute nap in a green room. You should be fine.
Well, you would think after the Good Day interview.
That would be it.
Right.
Yeah,
there.
But then they still brought her over.
They might be book people, though. They might not be her personal. You know what I mean?
Like, they just want to sell books.
Just get out there.
Just that thing.
She was with, like, a couple of people. Yeah.
Yeah.
They're, only one of them is the book person.
Yeah, but they're all in the business of Jenna Jameson.
I find them despicable. That they wouldn't protect her a little bit more and have her, you know, not do that. It was kind of embarrassing. It's fucking...
It is, but I kind of like the fact that she did it.
Oh, believe me. Yeah, I loved it.
Not just for us, but I like the fact that there's something really honest. Even if someone's falling apart,
yeah,
there's almost like, let people see what it is. Mm. Like, she's having a really hard time. I think she's in a bad place right now.
Yeah.
Let people see it. This way you don't just fucking read about it one day and go, oh, my fucking God. Like, let people see it and understand
but
what it
is. At the same time, that interview... can come back and haunt her in court now.
That's another thing.
And the Good
thing.
Day thing can come back and haunt her in court. You know?
A lot of people are saying that, like, oh, boy, that's testimony right there.
Yeah, I think it'll do good because she said in the interview that she's sober.
Yeah.
If it drives you to rock bottom, like, I wanted to, and I didn't ask you because I should have, but I feel like I'm watching a person hit bottom.
Right.
That's what it felt like when I was talking to her.
Yeah.
And that's always a good thing. Because when somebody hits fucking bottom... they can start to, you hope they don't die or wind up in prison, but
right.
That's the best way up and out is through bottom. So maybe this fucking horrible thing will help her out, I hope.
Yeah. I don't know. It's sad all around. Yeah. I know. It was very compelling to listen to. I got to give you guys that. That's for sure.
Your video is part of the Mirror's article.
No.
And they say that show hosts Jim Norton and Sam Roberts were visibly uncomfortable with the damaged state of their guests.
But that's,
literally, to ask the troubled blonde question.
That's not true that we were visibly. I didn't feel that uncomfortable.
You know what?
I didn't feel uncomfortable at all.
Regardless, it looked that way, but...
regardless of how you felt, when you watched the video, the way you're peering around, especially at that first breakdown she has.
Yeah, absolutely.
You're kind of, and you almost give this, you look at Sam at one point and almost like smile like, holy fuck, what are we doing?
Yeah.
What are we in here?
Yeah, there was definitely a feeling of, where is this going?
Right.
What are we going to do? What should we be doing here?
Yeah. You had an engine go out on you. That's the look you had. One engine went out.
If someone breaks down or cries, it's really weird. Like, I want it to be legitimate. Like,
yeah.
There's a really weird line where you don't want to be the vulture scumbag.
Yeah.
Like, that just when someone is down, you start kicking them and probing them. Like, ooh, this will sound good.
Yes.
And it's really, there's like a really weird balance with that.
Because we bash people that do that on TV.
Yeah.
When you see Barbara Walters, when they smell blood in the water, you don't want to be that guy.
But I also don't want to cover it either. Like, pretend it's not happening.
There was one part of the interview where she took a real long time to answer. A question was asked, and you heard her sniffling and kind of breathing funny. You knew she was very upset. And I don't know why, but I just pictured Jimmy like maybe putting his hand on her hand and like comforting her.
Well, he did.
As I was driving.
He did open the water for her.
Oh, you did?
And put it next to her and put the tissues. I did.
Well, they asked me for a tissue in my ear.
Oh.
E-Rock, which I thought was her publicist or somebody, which I should, but it was just good manners. I should have done it anyway.
Yeah.
E-Rock said, could you give her tissues? I should have thought of that.
There was a funny comment on the video because you can see Jim gets a bottle of water and opens it and puts it in front of her.
Yeah.
And they were like, did you learn nothing from Mike Francesa? There's no cap on that water.
You know, I didn't think of it. She actually, in that moment, collected herself better than I thought she was going to. Because she was, it was like, the question was something about what.
Well, the first question that got her was, "Are you okay?"
Yeah, are you okay? Yeah, because you were obviously concerned at her state there, so you asked if she was okay, and then the answer was
but how,
no.
But I didn't want to get into it, and again, how else to get into from this book, which is so different than the way she was being at that moment.
Uh-huh.
It was a really weird. It was like somebody promoting fucking balloons. Like, you know, they're out promoting balloons, but they walk in with a bandage on their wrist.
That's,
like, how do you...
That's exactly what it was.
Right.
Here's this book that's supposed to be sexy and fun and everything, and then she's just this depressed disaster on the radio. Yeah.
So it was...
It was compelling.
In that moment, better than, because it looked like she was going to really have that was later on. That was something about the courts. You might have asked something about Tito and what did he say, whatever it was. And she was ready to, but so that's why her pause. It sounded like something really fucking bad was coming.
Yeah, yeah.
But then she kind of collected herself.
But I think that also, the way she was able to collect herself and then get sad again and then come back from it, was that manic kind of your fucked up behavior. Because that was weirder than if she would have cried the whole time. Was the way she came out of it, and she's laughing, and then, you know. And then fucking Sam Roberts pops back in with a goddamn question that gets her all fucking upset again.
Towards the end of the interview, it was very upbeat, you know.
Yeah.
As I was trying to seg my way
into getting a date.
Into fucking her, yeah, yeah.
I wouldn't have fucked her in that condition. I honestly,
you text her?
Yeah, but not, you
just
know.
To say hi.
Wait till she passes out.
Even me.
Yeah, I know.
I couldn't do that.
You're a gentleman.
Nah,
at heart.
I'm a pig, but there's a point where, you know, someone's just too sad.
Yeah,
There's no way Jenna Jameson sleeps with me unless she's on the end of the plank. So, and to me, I would just feel too bad.
Well, we were talking about hitting rock bottom.
Yeah, oh, exactly. My God.
This is all a downward spiral leading to sex with Jim Norton.
Can you imagine if she woke up and looked at me and the next day went to rehab?
She actually just says, I need help.
I want to thank Jim Norton for being my absolute bottom. Because I woke up and I thought someone had left a Glad bag of shit next to me. And then it talked.
Shit.
But guys were hammering her, man. Like maybe it reminded them of somebody too. But I'm reading this, and I'm not a white knight. Like, hey guys.
Oh.
But I'm like, where is this fucking dislike of this woman who you've jerked off like an animal to?
That's the new fucking world we live in with social media, the instant ability to shit on people without any thought to it. Without any thought of consequence, with anonymity.
Yeah.
I mean, the ability to fuck with people now. And that's a lot of this bullying shit that's going on. And recently we've had, you know, people in their teens. One girl killed herself. Another boy, tried to kill himself. Because it's internet bullying for the most part. It's not even the old in-your-face, you know, punch the kid in the stomach in school bullying that goes on anymore. It's so easy to shit on somebody.
And it's the consistency of it, just constant
like hammering.
Following you home and never.
And even so, the victim puts the ammunition out there by posting pictures and everything. Their whole life is out there for you to shit on. They feel good about, you know, their picture with them and their dog or something, and then somebody just shits on it and says, oh, is that the dog that fucks your mother and shit like that? I mean, it's so easy to be 20,000 times more brutal than you had to be face to face.
I put photos of myself with my cat online.
Oh, is that the one with your long hair?
My friends.
You faggot. Is that the one?
That my friends make fun of me.
Everyone knows you have no friends.
Exactly.
And it's also the thing of like, okay, finally, pretty girl, I get to be better than you.
Yes.
I got to go tell the world and make sure that you know that now I get to be better at you.
Do you honestly think with fucking pizza face walking up in high school to the most beautiful girl, you would walk up to her and go, you fucking bitch, you're a piece of shit? No.
But to be fair, there were probably a lot of guys that were pizza faces that somebody like Jenna Jameson came up and was just like, oh,
and was shit
fuck
on.
Oh,
yeah.
Fuck
you.
Yeah.
Can't talk to me.
It goes both ways, but I don't think it was ever that brutal as it is online, because that anonymity and that distance gives you the fake fucking balls to say the worst, most horrific shit to people. And it's definitely having an effect on especially kids in school because kids, we know they're fucking brutal anyway. But now to have that outlet, it's fucking horrific.
And the weirdest thing is when you read it and then you go to the profile and it's like a picture of a guy with his two kids.
Yeah.
And you go, you're still doing this and you're raising kids?
Yeah.
Like, what if somebody was doing it
to, right,
to your kids? You'd think that once you have kids, you wouldn't do things that you wouldn't want people doing
right,
to your kids.
To your kids. I'm guilty of that when people strike first. Like, I won't just fucking shit on people.
Yeah.
But I've been shit on, and then I've just researched every bit of Facebook pictures and tweets and whatnot. I'll go back years in their tweets till I find a link of a picture with them and their kids, and I'll be like, your fucking daughter looks like a mongoloid.
And
your fucking wife is a fat pig piece of shit. Like, but, you know, you fired the first round.
And they want to treat you like you're a public figure, so I can say whatever exactly. I want. Well, fuck you. You made yourself a public figure. Now
there
I see what
you
your
go.
Kids look like.
You stepped into the public arena
right.
and publicly said something. There's a difference between somebody emailing you something and then somebody publicly at-mentioning
right.
you
yes.
and saying something.
But, know. Again, I would never walk up to these people and say, hey, your wife's a fat lump of shit and your kids are ugly.
While he's walking with
public,
his family.
Yeah, he's walking with his family. First of all, you get your fucking ass kicked.
Yeah.
Secondly, people just don't act like that in a civilized society.
It's mean.
But online, you're able to just be a fucking asshole.
Right.
And yeah, that's the type of bullying. Because I don't think in-school bullying is any different than it used to be. I remember
probably less actually now.
Probably you're probably right. I don't think there's this newfound bullying that goes on in school. Kids will fucking taunt each other. They'll push each other, smack each other in the head, whatever in school. But it's this online bullying that that really takes its toll. Yeah, I saw this yesterday.
Yeah.
Apparently, some kid, this Halsey Parkinson. My name's Halsey Parkinson. He was being bullied. Yeah, I know, with a name like that, you have to be. And I think he's a ginger. Yeah. You poor little fuck.
Is he the one that came with a gun or no?
No, he's a kid that was being bullied, and he put out a little thing on Facebook. Was
oh,
it his
video,
Facebook?
Yeah.
No, he said, hey, I need some friends. Apparently, this bully said, fuck, you don't have any friends. He was kind of hassling the kid. And the kid put it out on Facebook to car clubs, various car clubs. And they showed up at the school, hundreds of people, to back this kid up and say, hey, we're behind you. And he confronted the bully and talked to him. And him and the bully kind of, you know, shook hands and
the bully apologized.
The bully apologized to him and, you know, you do have friends. And it was kind of this uplifting little thing that happened. You know, it's kind of nice when
but
they don't bring
so
a gun to school.
Go or, the exact opposite way.
Where
this kid goes home and kills himself.
It's either he kills himself or he goes to the school and shoots the bully and a few other people. It kind of, yeah, that worked out. But that's the kind of shit that's going on. Oh, that kid obviously would be bullied. He kind of looks a little fruity. Kids like that, you know, always catch the brunt of shit. I think he's frosting his hair. E-Rock. He's got wacky glasses. I don't even know what, like, looks dorky in school these days.
You can't say, like, you think something that would have looked dorky is everybody's like, that's cool.
Yeah.
Skinny
yeah,
jeans
exactly.
and a fucking dildo hat, and all the girls love this kid.
dildo hats are in.
Fucking dildo hat. You are the shit. But then I'm watching him, and he's kind of dorky and stuff, and all these, like, chicks from school were coming up to him and hugging him. And like, we're behind you. It's like, this guy figured out the way to fucking get girls.
They're not going to date him.
No. You don't think?
No.
You think it's just friends?
Nobody yes. dates the redhead who calls the car club people to come and rescue him in a video.
They can support him all he wants, but they're not going to date him.
They're still going to fuck the bully.
Yes.
He's the guy bitches. That they tell their boyfriends, I wish you were as nice as him, but they don't leave their boyfriends.
And the boyfriend goes, you want me to be a fucking faggot?
Exactly.
And then she's like, oh, stop. Hall sucks his dick. And this poor fuck is going home with nothing.
Yeah, just looking at photos of cars.
Hey, he's going to get bullied again tomorrow.
Obviously, once the car club leaves, the bully's going to come back and go, remember that apology?
But good for
fuck your mother. Bam, right in the face. Oh, it's so, I don't know.
It's terrifying as a parent.
I'm trying to think back. You know how they say you remember, like, the better shit and kind of the bad shit goes off? I'm trying to remember, like, some real evil shit from school and stuff, and I don't know. I can't really place it. But it's got to be worse these days. I don't know why. I just think it is.
Is it because you cried so much that they all just blend together?
Oh, I was just so weepy. By high school, I had cut off all emotion. So it wasn't
really. That's
real.
Why you don't remember anything
I think
bad.
Junior high was the last time I was very emotional or felt bad or cried.
It's definitely worse now.
When my father told me, next time I see you crying, you better have an arrow in your chest. that was a quote, mind you, from my dad when
an
he
arrow
saw me
in
crying.
Your chest.
Not just, you know, sprain your ankle,
right.
Stub that toe, because that could bring tears.
Now, you did go to school when the Cowboys and the Indians were fighting, is that why?
That is exactly what happened. It was, I believe the Comanches were running rampant around Capistrano at the time. And it was a viable chance that an arrow would be in my chest.
Happened to children all the time.
See, what dad meant was, I never want to see you cry.
Oh,
hence the arrow in my chest.
Oh.
I never forgot that quote. I believe I was at some event. I remember there were bleachers, something. I was there. And I got a cramp in the back of my thigh. And it hurt very badly. And I straightened my leg out and went, ah! And I started crying.
Because you had a cramp?
It hurt really bad.
Were you in your period?
Right, look, I was probably 13.
Oh, that's awful. Oh.
And my dad did tell me at that point, next time you cry, you better have an arrow in your chest.
I wonder if you're secretly gay, but you cut off all your emotions, so you have no idea.
Yeah. Secretly?
Exactly.
like one day, like you'll start allowing emotions, and then you'll be like, I love men. And like,
yeah.
I don't know.
The next thing you know, he's bringing in fucking cum in a thermos.
Eating it like soup.
I don't even think the gayest of gay men do that, Jimmy.
But it is weird.
Come in a thermos.
Ant's such a nice guy. Like, people only hear the show, and they just hear this angry psychopath, and by them, I mean, we sit next to him. But then you see Ant with his dumb cat, or like something doesn't fit in that picture.
Yeah?
Like, yeah, and especially knowing what a sensitive, blubbering kid he was growing up, you don't just not become that person.
There is a wacky duality there, and I understand it because I will tweet horrific things about certain cultures on Twitter, and then
we've noticed
bookend it with adorable Beavis pictures. And I know that seems very psychopathic.
But you know what? That's a good example of the difference in the bullying thing.
Mm.
Why bullying is so much worse. Because imagine if you went home and you turned off the internet and just watched some fun TV, played with your little cat, and you just had a happy afternoon.
Yeah.
But you turn on the internet, and all these people are still right there.
They're right there.
And they're getting you upset.
I gotta comment.
And you gotta start tweeting, and you can never not be that guy. It's the same thing where if you're getting bullied in school, at least you could come home and play with your cat, right, Travis?
Huh? Travis, bullied, cat comment.
And I would walk in my house and just hug my cat.
Yeah.
That's right. Wondering who was singing Hava Nakila Hava in the next room.
Sorry, Travis.
I feel bad when I make fun of Travis. Yeah.
But if Travis had come home and hugged his cat and then turned on Twitter, and everybody was like, you're still a little gay boy. He'd be like, oh, even my cat can't make me feel better.
Maybe I'll just bleach my hair again. You little frisk.
This will be cool.
I'll look cool, and they'll like me now.
I did look cool.
You did look cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, there is no escaping it.
Yeah, like that's the difference.
Yeah, you used to be able to go home, and, okay, I don't have to deal with that again until, you know.
Yeah, there's no bully-free part of the internet that you could go to. You're either not using social media at all, or you're going to catch shit on it.
Like, imagine laying in bed. You're a kid.
All right.
Right? You're having a tough time in school.
Yeah.
Everybody's bullying you. You're laying in bed. You turn the lights off. You're like, okay, it's 11 p.m. I have nothing to worry about until tomorrow morning, finally. And then, like, 11:30, your phone goes off. It's just a text that says, hey, fuck yourself.
Oh.
It's like, I can't escape this.
I'm home.
Yeah.
This was my sanctuary.
I'm in bed. I'm being bullied in bed.
You knew when you left school and the bully gave you the last push in the mud puddle as before you got on that school bus or walked off the school property and got home, that you were safe from that time yeah. until at least you got on the bus the next morning and someone, Boomer Esiason, held your head and farted in your face.
You that happened?
You, oh, Jesus, did it ever.
He farted in your face?
Boomer used to do that to everyone. Boomer would walk around the cafeteria of Timber Point Elementary School in East Islip and grab kids' heads, put them down by his ass, raise his leg, go, and then just laugh.
He did it to you?
I think it happened to me at some juncture. It was always like Russian roulette.
Yeah.
His ass was always loaded with one fart, and you never knew who it was going to go off and whose face. Boomer was quite the bully. I'll give him that.
Yeah.
In school, he was the gym teacher's pet. He was very athletic, very big guy. And he was what you would consider, especially back then, a bully. He'd walk around. Everyone was afraid of him. You didn't fuck with him. You did not call him Norman. He was Boomer back then, man. His name was fucking Boomer. And if you called him Norman, as I did, you were obligated to then fight him, as I did.
Did you win or lose?
I punched him square in the forehead, first punch of the fight, and broke my ulna and radius in my arm. Oof. And now, a skinny little fucking...
Girl.
Yes, a skinny little girl like myself now is fighting the big Boomer with a broken arm, which is just, I was the limping gazelle at the waterhole with the mighty lion coming after me.
Did he ever fuck with you again after that?
No. Never again.
All you have to do is break your arm.
Yeah. You throw a punch at somebody's face. It's a weird psychology. You throw a punch
to the face.
I felt so good for a split second that I felt so good. And, well, then, you know, I got my ass handed to me. Thank God I kept my coat on, though. I kept my big, dumb 70s snorkel jacket on. Remember those snorkel jackets? And that I kept it on. Everyone used to strip their clothes off when they fought. And I always thought, that's ridiculous. I want padding.
Right.
So I kept the padding on. But I'll tell you one thing. It was a good old-fashioned schoolyard fight between two white kids. So there was there was no five other people coming in to stomp me on the head and steal my not-invented cell phone yet.
Right.
Yes.
But see, like, I mean, you run home.
Uh-huh.
Away from Boomer.
Right.
And once you finally get to your front door and shut the door.
Yes.
Home free. Imagine.
Home free.
You run home.
Right.
You shut the door.
Oh.
Home free. You walk into the kitchen. Whew. You pour yourself a bowl of Fruit Loops or whatever your cereal of choice is.
Delicious.
And then you get a tweet that says, you're fucking dead.
Oh, I'd be like,
why
what happened?
Why is it still here?
Ah, how's your arm, faggot?
Right.
How about that? I'm like, wait a minute.
When did Boomer get Twitter?
What happened?
Yeah, well, you're going on Facebook. It's the constant. We've all gotten pounded online before, and you feel like everyone is in on it. Like, even though, like, you've been getting killed for something, and you're like, oh, my God, everyone's in a room getting me.
Yes. Because you don't realize that the people who don't hate you aren't aware that this is happening. So they're not there to say, hey, just so you know, I don't hate you.
Right. Yeah, that doesn't happen.
No, why would you? Why would you tweet somebody randomly and say,
you just wouldn't.
Hey, buddy, I don't hate you.
Right. It's just got to be worse now, though. I mean,
I never thought of that angle about going home, because I was always like, well, you just block people. But that's a good point about how you can't stop
it. Escape.
It's always, our lives are so online, you can't stay off the computer.
Did you ever bully anybody? Ever?
Maybe a couple of weaker kids, but not much. Like, no, I was always trying to stave off the fact that I was a cocksucker. And just fucking, I was always just trying to be funny and not be bullied myself.
You ever bully anybody?
Yeah, I didn't realize I was bullying people. But in hindsight, I feel really bad about it. Because I used to, like, there'd be select kids that were fun to make fun of.
Yes,
and I would do it all the time.
I blame them for being such fucking dickbags. Yeah. That it's like, why are you making me do this to you?
Yeah,
Sam and I were incredibly similar as high school students,
except you were gay.
Yeah, right. But that's why I bullied.
Oh,
so that people wouldn't put their attention on me.
Right,
and that's the other thing. Yeah, like I was small. and weird looking.
So you had to build yourself up by shitting on someone else.
Just immediately start firing.
Right, right.
And there'd be people that were fun to make fun of. And I would do it every day, all day.
It's like Welcome to the Dollhouse. You ever see that movie?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
It's fucking great. It's great. And the shit that goes downhill, like no matter how badly someone's being bullied and how bad they feel about being bullied, they will turn around and fuck with the next dickhead down the ladder to them because it just makes them feel a little better. It's a really good, sick kind of indie flick from the 90s.
It was good.
Yeah, yeah.
You had braces, right?
Yeah, she was just the most pathetic thing. But I fell into that thing, too, where there were a couple of instances when I was in school, one in elementary school, another one in, even in high school, where you get caught up in it. Someone is such a complete fucking douchebag, not even mean or anything. They're just like, ugh, I don't know why, but I feel compelled to push you and throw your sneakers in the mud and shit like that because you're a dick and everyone does this. And it seems fun. Like, there is something entertaining about fucking with somebody.
Well, it just feels powerful.
Yes, it's a powerful thing.
It's not you.
No, it's not you getting pushed in the mud.
Like, we had this kid in our neighborhood, and I can't count the amount of times.
Oh, this kid. Really, Trav?
Was it a he, girl?
Yes.
Boy,
did he have
Travis.
A cat?
I bet it's Travis.
Oh, fuck.
But I can't count the amount of times we sent him home crying, like, just playing.
And then you'd laugh as he cried.
Yeah,
that's hilarious. Yes. He's crying again.
He went home crying.
We've reached our goal, everyone. We made him cry.
And you think about it now, and you're like, God damn.
I destroyed that person's life.
Yeah.
Like, I was also.
He had a terrible childhood because of me.
But you're oblivious at that age to other people's feelings.
Yeah.
You don't understand that. Like, I remember in seventh grade. There were these mean girls, and they told me a list of all the boys that all these girls had crushes on.
Oh, man.
And they were like, you should send out an email and send it to everybody that has all this information on it.
Ooh.
And I was like, yeah, that'd be funny. And so I did it.
Uh-oh.
And, like, every girl was furious with me, and I couldn't understand why.
You asshole.
And then later I realized that was a real fucking dick thing for me to do.
Yeah, yeah. The when you think back, though, before any of the internet and stuff and the fact that I did it and other people bullied kids, the immediacy of the ability to bully people online now is just astounding. So you understand how, like, some of these kids are fucking offing themselves, which is crazy. I even felt bad after the fact. Like there was this fucking kid. I've talked about it before. Poor Patrick Fullen, and he was a fat, fucking cherub face, rosacea looking douchebag that made the funniest face when you punched him in the stomach. Just the funniest dumb face, and everyone punched him in the stomach to make him do the face. Do the face, wham, and you punch him in the stomach, and I just. Like, even afterwards, I go home and kind of be like this very show.
Mm-hmm.
When you're here, everything's hunky-dory.
It's funny.
The second I'm getting into my truck, I might feel a little bad about what I said while I sit here. Same thing. Poor Patrick Fullen.
Why'd I make Bobo take his pants off?
Right, exactly.
But then,
exactly.
Then you see Patrick tomorrow, and you're like, it'd be really funny if I punched him in the stomach right now.
Gotta see that face!
But you also, you never forget being bullied. And you don't realize, because... I'll never forget, in kindergarten.
Oh, no.
My first day of kindergarten in England.
Someone dropped the N-bomb, right?
No.
Oh, but that's probably what they did.
These three boys came up to me, and they said, we hate you. And I went, what?
Did they sound like the Wall album? We hate you.
No, they
were... All in all, it's just another brick in the wall. We hate you, little American pecker.
Yeah.
No?
They were American.
Yeah.
What?
Yeah, yeah. I went to an American school in England.
You're living on an Air Force base?
Mm-hmm. Sam wanted to have some pudding, and they said, you can't have your pudding until you've eaten your meat. You can't have your pudding until you've eaten your meat.
I'm going to kick you in your twigs and berries. No?
No.
Oh.
They punched me in the stomach, though, after they said they hated me.
Did you make a funny face? I'll tell the kids out there, if someone punches in the stomach, do not make a funny face.
Because they will do it again.
They will just tomorrow... right back at you.
But that was kind of the end of it.
Yeah.
But even that one isolated incident stayed with me forever.
You remember.
Forever. And you'll never forget.
Did you call a Bobby?
No, I didn't.
You didn't call the
Bobby.
Bobbies on him?
No.
They called the Bobby.
They were utterly defenseless. They had no firearms.
He'd have come and gone, "What's all this then?" Because that's what they say.
All right, all right.
All right, all right. What's all this then?
And now imagine that every single day.
Yeah. Oh. They all look like the Artful Dodger.
Yeah.
They're all fucking like urchins.
They have newsy hats on.
Yeah.
I mean, you really just...
No, I was just going to, you know... It was nothing. You know, like they're fucking
all right,
from the tough side of town.
Yeah. Ah, that's a fair cop. It was nothing.
I did. Yeah.
And you realize the cops are like Clockwork Orange cops, and then they take you and they put your face in the trough. You think they're rescuing you?
poor little Sam in England.
Well,
little Sam Roberts. What have we got here? Well. I just looked up at him, not blinking.
Right.
Those piercing blue eyes.
Oh.
Well.
Little Sam doesn't have any warbles, does he? No? Did that happen?
Homeless man came up to me and got his comeuppance.
Yes. Aw.
And did you kill some old lady because she hit your giant penis statue?
Did you engage in some ultra-violence as a kid?
Ultra-violence?
Walking around with all my clothes in a brown paper.
Yes.
Pull it up in brown paper with a ribbon.
Did someone try to save you from yourself? Did you try the wine?
No, but I would go up to girls and ask if they wanted to little of the old in-out.
Ah, yes.
What have you got at home to play your fuzzy wobbles on? Oh, she's in your liquor ice cream and she punches you in the face.
Little Sam Roberts in England.
I was so pissed. My mom, I was gone from the house and she gave away my pet snake that I kept in a drawer.
Oh, no.
That's right.
What did she do that for? It's kind of mean.
It was a battery-operated snake that he would shove in his anus.
Aw.
I love the vision of the future in that movie is microcassettes.
It really is. Microcassettes is where
we're playing music off of.
I did like the fact in Clockwork Orange that they did kind of make this futuristic vision that it kind of was, you could believe it.
Yep.
It wasn't so wacky far in the future.
Flying cars.
Yeah, flying cars and everything. It was
People just walking around.
You felt like it was the future and the government was all fucked up and, you know.
Yeah.
There was this weird thing going on, but they didn't have to put rocket ships in it to be like, hey, look, it's the future.
People hang out with robots now.
Right, yeah, hey, robot, get me something. Right.
And the microcassettes were actually a pretty fucking insightful thing for 1971.
Mm.
But even though we passed that technology, that they were around for a while,
those little
teeny cassettes.
Oh, I remember those, sure.
Back when they were playing big records, that seemed like this amazing portable piece of music.
Amazing technology.
Weirdo comes over and tries to give me advice while I'm in my tidy whities walking around the house.
Yes.
Your chief collective advisor.
Yeah.
Going to the milk bar.
Yeah.
How great was that?
That was fucking great.
I heard Jared Leto, somebody on our show said that he owns one of those little...
He's a weird guy. One of the figures
from the Corova.
Jared Leto at one of the comedy shows. One of the...
West Palm.
Oh, West Palm, right?
When you had to intro that concert they were doing.
Yes! That's where he was. He was all fucking weird makeup on and everything.
Because he was in band mode.
Well, I guess he's permanently in band mode now. I haven't seen him in a movie in American Psycho.
Jordan Catalano was a long time ago.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Requiem for a Dream was good?
Yep. Yeah, he's been good.
Yeah, you like him?
He's so handsome.
He is dreamy.
Those eyes.
Kind of give you that.
Everybody. Yeah. Yep. Uh-huh, definitely. Yeah.
Agreed. Yeah. We should take a break.
Yeah.
I got some wonderful breakfast here. I would love the listeners to hear me eat it, but we're going to... Oh, look at that. Wow.
What's that?
Jordan Catalano.
Is that Jared Leto?
Yeah.
My so-called life.
Okay.
Exactly. Did you watch that show?
I really liked that show.
Oh, of course you did.
I enjoyed it.
I was more
Sam did too.
Party of Five guy myself.
Oh, Party of Five? What a loser.
Well, you know what? Hot. Come on.
Yeah. I guess Travis and I were like grunge era kids at that time, and you were like 42?
Hey, I don't think I was 42.
I'm bad with names.
But, you know, I'd rather say that than say what else I was watching, like Clarissa Explains It All.
You were?
Oh, I well, loved
we were
Clarissa.
Watching that too,
Clarissa was the shit.
I loved watching Clarissa.
Because the kid who came in the window was named Sam, and I was like, I wish I was as cool as that Sam.
Exactly. Oh. You should be coming in a window. That's what you should be doing, just jerking off in shrubs.
I used to love Nickelodeon. I watched Clarissa.
See, Secret World of Alex, man.
I watched Pete and Pete.
Pete and Pete's a great show.
I watched some of the cartoons, fucking Football Head. They're,
Hey Arnold.
Hey Arnold.
I was talking about this the other day. Like, those Nickelodeon's shows when we were growing up were written so smart, and they were written so well, they didn't talk down to kids. And now the shit that's on Nickelodeon now, it's just... It's
what, you mean overacting kids being smart alecks to their parents?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. That whole thing, it's... Yeah, I don't get it. That whole, like, fucking the kids and, yeah, they're smart alecks.
I always wanted to be cool Sam coming through the window, but I always knew I was more like Ferguson.
Oh, you were Ferguson.
I knew.
Oh. Ferguson was the douche.
He was a fucking douche.
What a great name. Ferguson. Yeah.
Oh,
look at him.
Face.
Fucking.
I knew.
He's one of those daywalker gingers.
Good head of hair on that little bastard, though.
Oh, big red head. He's probably fucking completely bald now. No, oh, he is.
Yep.
Wait a minute. He is. He looks like that gay gymnast.
Moby?
Or the radio wizard. He
looks like Seth Green.
Or Seth Green with a shaved head. How did he lose that big, full head of red hair?
And he started losing it, and he just got rid of it, because there's nothing worse than wispy red hair.
No, but only some people can shave that shit. Man, so you got a good fucking shaved head, Jim.
Thank you.
Nice shape to it and everything. Some people, they shave their head, it just fucking screams chemotherapy.
Yeah, I got a pale watermelon perched on my neck.
Can't have that.
Can't have
it. Oh, it's great. Nothing in it.
I knew, too.
Big,
my
empty
brother,
dinosaur egg.
My brother fucking pulls off the shaved head.
Yeah.
Fine.
Yeah.
He can fucking pull it off. He grows mutton chops and a beard and fucking the shaved head, and it's fine. Me, I had to spend whatever money I had to keep every little fucking bit of hair on top of my head, because the shaved head, for me, an undertaker would be following me around thinking I had mere hours left. Can't pull it off.
If you grow a goatee and scowl a lot, people think you're like Walter White.
No. Walter White, another one that pulled off that fucking shaved head thing perfectly. I just don't have it.
No.
I don't have that look. The shaved head, it saved a multitude of bald guys.
And black dudes. I mean, black dudes got it.
Any black dude can pull it off. Any black dude can pull off the shaved head.
Black women can pull it off since Uhuru.
Uhura?
Was she bald or no?
Uhura.
Was she bald?
No, she had a full head of hair.
Who am I thinking of? A bald black woman? I'm thinking of somebody. I can't remember the name.
Yeah.
I have no idea.
Every one of them, if you take the weaves out their head, or the fucking
waves. No, I'm thinking of somebody.
Hair.
I can't. All right.
I can't. Let me see. Does anyone know? Erica Badu.
So she had a big. No, she didn't have a bald head.
Did she?
Had a giant.
Grace Jones. No.
Grace Jones was bald.
Grace Jones had. No, she had like a mohawk thing. She
but I mean, very, very short. Not
she had the fade up
oh,
the side.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, she had a head of hair on her.
Yeah, she's very pretty.
She's
who's
frightening.
Who's the Sting? Or no, Sting. Who's the bang Grace Jones?
Oh, yeah, who banged Grace Jones? There was a white dude,
I'm
right?
I'm thinking of David Bowie and Iman.
Yeah.
Or Iman, not Imam.
Iman.
They're still married, I think.
Are they really?
Yeah.
Dolph Lundgren. Did Dolph used to bang her?
That would have been an awesome photo.
Right? Holy shit. Imagine what that would look like, the contrast.
Yeah.
Fucking, you wouldn't need any fucking Instagram filters on that picture.
Chiseled jaws. Fucking.
Oh, my God. Yeah.
Be intimidating.
What the hell am I doing? I gotta eat.
All right, we'll be right all back. Right. And, stay tuned.
Ah.
I'll be so sorry.
The Opie and Anthony Show.
What's that?
Ooh.
Oh, okay.
Ooh, a little hotter than hell.
Is that what this is? Any reason for this, Mr. Rock?
Only because it's Kiss and Jimmy. 39 right. years ago, this was released.
Kiss and Jimmy, I bet you wish you were.
Ah, look out. Kiss, huh?
Yeah.
I realized when I went to see Kiss that time they were around and we all went to see them, how few Kiss songs I really know.
Yeah.
Really?
Like, I know their hits, their big hits. And those are kind of few, if you really think about it. And they played a lot of songs. I was just like, what the fuck is this? I don't even know this song.
One of my favorite Kiss songs off of record. It's off of Dress to Kill. It's called Getaway. Peter Criss sang a couple of great fucking Kiss songs.
Do you know he did Beth?
I did not know that.
You know,
that
was supposed to be
Ace and Paul.
It was supposed to be Beck, from what I hear.
Uh-huh. That's right.
And Gene saved the whole universe, apparently, by...
All of its success hinged on Gene Simmons.
Always on Gene. Is this the song you were just talking about, Gene?
Oh, Getaway, yeah.
Getaway?
I like a lot of Kiss songs.
I wouldn't know this.
Yeah, so this is like a... I think Dress to Kill had Rock and Roll All Night on it.
It's a very basic
song, but I just like... Peter Criss and this, and I think that he never got the accolades.
A little riff, very common riff right there. See, this is, it's very generic, but
it works.
Very generic song, yeah.
Well, I don't think so. It's very old.
Well, it
Everyone
is old.
Everyone has been ripping this off since 1974. I don't care for it.
I think they've been ripping this rip off since fucking the 30s. Very good. A little Kiss.
I had to, I had to get my sleep study last night.
Yes, I wanted to ask you how that went. Everybody is in a tizzy, wondering how your sleep study went, Jimmy.
I do understand nobody cares, but I had to get...
No!
I went, I was on no sleep yesterday, so I went to, I had to get, I wanted to get one Ambien for my study, because they put you... Probably 30 wires attached to you.
How do you get one Ambien?
I had my doctor prescribe it. I went to my doctor and I asked her to prescribe one.
One Ambien, please!
I did that last year. One pill. But she wrote it up for a regular prescription, so I get to the pharmacy.
Uh-oh.
And the guy goes, well, this is for 30.
Oh, shit.
And I'm like, I only want one.
Bring some friends.
And he's like, I have to give you the whole thing.
Oh.
So I walked home with 30 Ambien. Fucking immediately, 29 of them went in the toilet.
Really?
Before I fucking took my shoes off, 29 Ambien down the toilet.
Wow. Is it that you didn't trust yourself?
Absolutely, I don't trust
myself. Wow.
Because there's this junkie mentality of like, it's like, I'm going to save one for this study.
Uh-huh.
But then I'm like, you know, you might want to save one because if this one doesn't work,
oh boy,
then you're going to have to get into the sleep study. And I'm like, shut up, douchebag. You go to the doctor again, you get the prescription.
Or what if you slept very soundly after you took it? And then you'd be like, well, you know what? I could just take another one, make myself sleep a little better. I have such a, I think a lot of the listeners, too, has such faith in you, like, and your sobriety. You talk about, and I listen to your advice show, and you talk about how it's a daily struggle, and you still, you know.
We're vigilant. Sometimes it's not a struggle, but it's like daily vigilance.
Yeah. But it's like nobody can picture you sliding.
And it can happen. Believe me.
I understand that. Yeah. It's like one of those things. But, I mean, I don't think there's really anybody out there that could picture you sliding because you seem very, very together when it comes to your sobriety. Everything else is fucking out of whack. You're a fucking lunatic. But that sobriety thing, I think it would crush a lot of people if you ever did slip.
Yeah, I mean, but it's amazing how your mind works after all these years. It doesn't just say, take five and get fucked up, man. It doesn't say that.
Yeah.
Because my mind, it's like too basic a fucking, but it's like, just save one.
Right.
There was the one part when I was holding the thing, I'm like, you could just take all these and you'd be dead.
Oh, my God.
I wasn't going to do that, but right now. I very rarely have that shit.
It probably also helped you to get rid of them spending the morning with Jenna Jameson.
but that doesn't really matter. Because, again, I've seen so many people in worse shape than her. That was just that's just one of many people you see having a rough day.
And Ambien it's pretty il potente, as they say. But it's not like you have morphine in your hands or anything.
Right.
You know.
Maybe I couldn't have killed myself.
But
I don't
still,
know
but still you know, that mentality was there where you're like,
And I couldn't get it down the toilet. I saved one out of the 30, and they wouldn't
probably
flush.
A big log you fucking put in there.
Dude, they were all sticking to the fucking, I'm flushing, and I come back, and there's 20 of them still stuck to the bottom of my toilet. So I took a shit on them and knocked them loose.
Very symbolic.
That was what I did. Yeah. I took a awful post-workout veggie juice dump on them and knocked them loose.
Shit.
And I get there at fucking 8 p.m., and it's not like the other place I went. You don't have your own bathroom. You have to share a bathroom. And
with who?
Just whoever else is up there. It's
other
like
people
a medical area.
Ugh.
And it's like the day room at Rikers Island. There's like fucking six black guys watching a football game being loud. I'm like, oh, this
What's
is a
about?
Fucking nightmare.
Were they working there or study?
A couple of them were working, but the other ones were there for other kind of studies. They had people that do, like, volunteer, like I guess, paid.
Crime studies, right.
or just brainwave stuff and sleep.
Oh, boy.
Beep. So I had to wait 2 hours to get. I'm like, how long will it take you to put all the wires on? And the guy's like, I got about 40 minutes.
Jesus.
So,
a lot of wires.
I took a cold medicine because I was very congested in coffee. And I bit the Ambien in half. I took half of the one pill I had. And that fucking mask went on me.
Mm.
And I slept. I kept waking up. I can only sleep a little bit.
Yeah.
I'm a bad fucking sleeper, man.
That's a goddamn
on cold medicine
bitch.
And a half an Ambien. And I don't indulge at all. And I still kept waking up every fucking hour. And I went and pissed a couple of times. You have to carry all these wires with you. And it's a fucking nightmare, dude.
How do you not knock the wires off while you're sleeping?
You're just laying there. I was laying on my back still. You don't move.
I can't move. Sleep on my back like
I can't
that.
Either.
I need to be curled up.
Yeah.
Fetal position.
Yeah.
Yes.
I think he got enough data. And then it was like 3 o'clock in the morning. I woke up. I'm like, I'm awake. There's no.
That's
I wasn't going to take the rest of the pill. I'm like,
is somebody awake, like monitoring the whole time?
They're watching you on a camera. You just speak out loud in the room. And I'm like, I got to pee. And I guess he was with another patient. So I just unplugged myself and went. And I'm like, I'm not going to sleep again. And I made myself lay there.
You must sleep, Mr. Norton. You must sleep and eat. Eat for the trip, Mr. Norton. It's a cookbook. It's a cookbook.
So I got a little more sleep, but I'm hoping I got enough data, man. Fucking done with these cunting sleep studies.
Yeah. Yeah. But the mask you said was working.
It was the machine that I needed called the ASV machine, and it was so much more comfortable than the other ones.
What does that do differently?
When it senses I stop breathing completely because of my central apnea, it breathes for me.
Calls your family and congratulates them.
Yeah, it writes Sirius a letter and buys stock options.
Wow.
I'll know the results, whatever, but hopefully I
stop. How long before you know? You don't know?
Yeah, God, white gunk on me.
Bitch. Yeah, I see that. Like, what is that, glue from the fucking...
Yeah, they have to fucking exfoliate like 30 different spots on your body and rub with alcohol and then put these fucking... It's like being hooked up to a...
God.
It's like you're a test dummy. That's what you're hooked up like.
Well,
you
are at that point, yeah. Without the test part.
Yes, I'm just a non-breathing dummy.
Oh, shit.
So.
Well, good luck, Jimmy.
Thank you.
I'm talking about this guy. Remember the guy, the Jets fan? He popped that fucking Patriots chick in the face at the game the other day. Apparently, he's been a very bad boy over the years. This guy, Kurt Paschke. He's the guy who's caught on video punching this chick. Chick got in his face. You know, we talked about it yesterday. It's never good to pop a girl in the face, but as Chris Rock said in one of his very funny comedy bits, I understand. I understand.
You
can't kill
a
bit, but I understand. Oh, did you, Chip?
Yeah.
When? What was the context?
My mother was getting a floorboard fixed by Lamar. I'm like, what are you doing? She's like, you wouldn't understand. I'm like, I understand.
That's not even close to what Chris Rock was talking about.
And Chip. it never happened.
Chip, fuck you.
Good.
Just, I've had it. So this guy, now they kind of reached back in history, and when he was 17 years old, he stabbed someone and killed them.
What?
So apparently he has a little anger issue. He did 3 years in the jern for killing somebody. This guy, first of all, he's from Long Island. Now, I take pride in being from Strong Island, as they call it, Strong Island. But, man, what a collection of douchebags has come from this little strip of real estate to the east of New York City. This guy is the typical Long Island dickbag. Everything from his high school yearbook picture to the video of him punching a chick in the face spells douchebag.
I'm curious if he's a fan of the show because
he probably is.
I'm getting word that one of our former interns is friends with him and he's giving me his number right now.
Which intern?
Paul.
Which one was that?
He also worked here for a period of time.
We almost hired him.
Oh, yeah, Paul with the bandana.
Oh, bandana Paul.
His mother made better fucking snacks than Sam's mother.
No, he doesn't work here anymore?
No, we hired Sal instead of him.
But I thought he was working here.
Nope.
No.
He was good.
We erred in judgment.
We really did. We got Sal. We got Sal.
Sal, I'm behind your hiring 100%, and I think you're doing good.
Why is that?
That's a mugshot.
When he walks in with a pistol, I want him to know who not to shoot.
Oh. Yeah, gonna watch that. Wow, he knows it. Wow, that's fucking cool. I hope we get his number. But I'm just gonna say, he looks like one of these Long Island douchebags.
It's even more of a reason not to punch a woman in the face at a public event.
Right?
If in your past you've stabbed and killed somebody.
You do 3 years for killing somebody.
Yeah.
And I guess he claimed self-defense. His mother has been coming to this guy's defense. And this is another one of these typical fucking things. Mothers are fucking assholes. Gotta be honest with you. They just jump to the defense of their fucking putrid little offspring no matter what. And this guy is no exception. She said that the stabbing was involved some white supremacist or something that was hassling him, and he stabbed him.
And he's white.
Yeah, I know. I don't get it.
This is his Jetsmobile, by the way. He owns that.
Oh, he takes that to the tail. Yeah. This guy, I'm sure he's got a man cave in his mom's house.
It's a short bus.
Oh, does he look like a fucking douche?
It's a school bus that's painted white and has the Jets logo all over it.
Look, there's this pal flipping the bird. He's flipping the bird.
By the way, backyard
from fucking the South Shore.
Doesn't give a fuck.
No.
If you're over 13 and you think you're cool giving the middle finger in a photo, you're an ass.
Yeah. Yes.
How else do you prove that you're badass in a single photo?
Yeah.
Jetsmobile.
Jetsmobile is pretty good.
Jetsmobile.
It says Jetsmobile on it, too.
I hope he gets sued for using the logo without permission.
I bet he drives that to the games, right? And then other Jets fans beep, and he looks at him out the window and goes, yeah!
He wants to be one of those celebrity super fans. Jetsmobile guy is here.
He wants to be the new fireman, Ed.
But instead, he's the guy who punched a woman in the face at a Jets game.
He's just the stab-happy guy.
You know the Jetsmobile? What? Oh, I think I saw that at tailgate. That's mine. Oh, man, you're a Jetsmobile guy? Yeah, that's me.
Now the Jetsmobile is synonymous with stabbing people and beating women.
And punching women in the face.
In the face.
So his mom rallies behind him and says that he was defending her. I guess, Mom, this is a family affair. The Jetsmobile can haul the entire family to the game, apparently. So the mom was there. And the line they're using is that he was defending his mom.
From what?
When he punched that waifish Pats fan in the face.
Who did shove him.
Yeah, I understand. But, you know, if you're that big and a skinny fucking chick pushes you, you respond in kind, perhaps. You push her back a little. Maybe you grab her arms and say, knock it off. You turn to the guy and say, control your chick, you faggot.
Right.
Something. But he decided to step it right up to punch her in the face.
Yeah, if you're a big galoot from Long Island.
He is a goon, isn't he?
Big galoot.
Who drives a Jetsmobile.
All right, look, you got to take the good with the bad. The Jetsmobile is pretty awesome.
Well, it's badass.
It is badass.
Do you want to guess what the theme of his birthday cake this year was?
J-E-T-S, Jets.
He loves the Jets.
Oh, does he love the Jets.
When the Daily News went to his mom's house to interview her, there was a half-eaten Jets-themed birthday cake for her son.
How can somebody like the Jets that much, you'd think that going to a Jets game would be the happiest they'll ever be. Like,
no.
Especially when
they won.
Yeah, they won the game, and he still is leaving the building, punching women in the face on his way out.
I wonder if the guy he stabbed bled Jets green. Or if it was just regular red blood gushing out of him until he collapsed and died on the floor. I'm not sure.
I just gave Eric a phone number. We're going to see if it's him.
Oh, well, do tell. Do tell.
I don't know if he'll talk. Pending charges.
I'm sure there are pending charges.
Tell him it's the Boomer and Carton show. He'll talk to Boomer.
That's true. He probably loves the Boomer.
We'll just tell him, you know, throw the fingers, middle fingers up.
What's this guy's first name?
Kurt.
Yeah. Tell Kurt, if he asks, just tell him we just want to say fuck the haters.
You.
Yeah. If we're saying fuck the haters, he'll be like, all right, put me through.
Kurt.
Tell him we got some Jets cake for him.
Yeah,
we want to pimp his Jetsmobile.
Oh, yeah. Look at that. Big Jets flag.
Exhibit. Yeah.
Big American flag.
Chip, you like it?
Cool.
You like football, Chip?
I don't give a fuck.
Oh, I forgot.
It's painted Jets green and white.
Yeah.
The Jetsmobile is awful.
You don't like it?
No, I don't.
It's a short bus.
It is. It's the short bus.
It's a big Jets flag. How will you stop with the Jets?
Oh, does he love the Jets?
But he drives a short bus to a Jets game.
He's a season ticket holder.
Yeah.
Normally takes his dad to the games, but mom went on Sunday because she's a breast cancer survivor.
Oh, my God.
And October is the month for raising awareness.
I bet you that the Jets revoke his season tickets if it's a problem.
Oh, man. That would be awful for him.
It should take his bus away. Somebody goes up to him and says, would you take the short bus here to this Jets game? And he'd be like, yes, as a matter of fact, I did.
I did.
I did take the short bus.
It's the Jetsmobile.
It's a Jetsmobile, though.
Yeah. Didn't you see it's parked out there?
Okay. Yeah. Pretty cool, huh?
Tailgating. What happened?
Uh-huh. Voicemail.
Voicemail?
Yeah, we'll try again.
What does it say? Hey, fuck. If you're a bitch, leave your message so I could come over the house and punch you in the face. Yeah, a little manslaughter charge, I guess, he got for stabbing. Man, if you stab and kill someone and do 3 years...
Yeah, keep your hands to yourself at that point.
That right there ends your career of fucking with people physically.
You shouldn't even want to draw attention to yourself anymore.
Exactly.
Like, he shouldn't even be driving the Jetsmobile at that point.
It'd be like, oh, that's the guy that stabbed that guy.
Everyone's exactly.
The Jetsmobile.
It's not like there's two Jetsmobiles out there.
What, you mean the Stabmobile? Yeah, he calls it the Jetsmobile, but we know.
We all know what it is. It's the Manslaughtermobile.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, mom's like that blind fucking support for kids.
Mom's saying it was self-defense.
I don't know what that's all about.
That those Pats fans jumped them.
Oh, nice. Yeah. Kurt.
That's what she's saying.
Were they just arguing and they got jumped? That happens sometimes too. You're arguing with people and they take a swing at you.
Yeah.
She said they were tormented by a pack of obnoxious Patriots fans.
At a football game? That doesn't sound right.
But in Jet Stadium, really?
Sure, why not?
I mean, will the visitors really start fucking with the home team?
Yeah, have you ever gotten drunk before?
Never.
Yeah, I mean, absolutely.
Yeah.
Mm.
All you need to do is get drunk, and then these people just act like the assholes that they are.
You ever have mommy defend you? Sorry, Trav, you're out of this. Roberts. For everything, I'm sure.
You should have heard when I was in school. I told her that my band teacher in sixth grade, I played the drums in the band.
Oh, rock.
And,
but in the stupid school band, not like a rock band.
And I couldn't even play. Like, that's terrible. I forgot my drumsticks half the time and just sat there.
You'd always practice on the skin flute.
Playing a drum.
No, exactly. That's why you were terrible at the drums.
Expert
at the skin flute.
Yeah.
But my mom found out that on the first day of like sixth grade, he said, right now, you will all listen to me. You are bottom feeding slime suckers. And he went on this whole rant, and that was the quote I remember, bottom feeding slime suckers. And I told
Henry Sergeant Hartman.
Yeah. Of drums.
Yeah.
And I told my mom.
Mm-hmm.
She made such a stink with the school.
Oh, yeah, man.
Such a stink.
One of those anti-bullying moms. Your, like, moms like yours are the ones who are responsible for this nonsense that everyone's dealing with.
Yes,
she didn't like me being called a slime sucker.
Are you embarrassed that she did that?
No, because I got out of band class, so I was fine with it.
Good deal.
They let me just sit in the guidance counselor's office for the whole period because they knew there was a problem, so I didn't mind it.
What a douche.
We have a call.
Oh, do we?
Yeah.
Well, we should take it.
Sir, you're on the air.
Hi, Colin.
I was so afraid you guys were going to go, speaking of bottom feeding slime suckers.
Now that would have been good.
That would have been a real zinger.
Yes. Colin Quinn.
I'm only calling because I understand there's a problem. Speaking of bullying, I feel like Jim Norton is bullying Bobo about our tour. He's saying,
oh, God. This is a Twitter fucking rock opera that's going on with Colin and Bobo. Apparently, I don't know how Bobo got this idea, but Bobo is under the impression.
And I don't know who's encouraging it either.
I have no idea. Bobo is under the impression that there's...
I don't know how you got this idea. Neither did the most finest neurologist.
apparently, there's going to be this car tour. Bobo and Colin are going to tour the country, stopping in cities near you, and go from New York to L.A. Together and broadcast and do call-ins to this program and just have a great time.
Yeah. Well, he's had a bunch of great suggestions.
Yeah, he did. Yeah,
bunch of them. Huh?
What are a couple of them, Carl?
Well, that in each city we stop and we talk to a local person that we know in each state.
Now, how do you know people in various cities? I know Bubba's never been out of New York, and you know,
apparently been out of Maspeth.
Yeah, I know Colin tours around, but you don't really make friends and meet people.
But some of the helpful Twitter followers have given suggestions how they'd like to meet up and, you know, possibly bring weaponry and.
Yes, I did see that. I kind of joined in on the fun and posted a couple of video clips of what I perceive the trip will be like. One was a clip of Maury being stabbed in the back of the head from Goodfellas. I thought he'd never shut the fuck up. I love that line. Another one, I wished you well on your trip and hoped it went as well as the picture that I posted. And it, of course, was Kennedy with his head exploded, being cradled by his loving wife. you're encouraging this. I've seen that.
Well, I mean, I just felt bad because I heard Friday Bobo called in to kind of promote the tour, and then just eviscerated him.
It didn't go well. We were in the middle of Jocktober. Things were happening, and Bobo just called up with this non sequitur about some car tour with Colin Quinn.
It is literally one self-centered, nonsensical moment after another. And I fucking had my fill of it. I know that Bobo is not the best decision maker, but in the middle of something else, it's just this fucking, just banal fucking, we're going to be driving.
Yes.
Shut up! For fuck's sake!
He is just fucking trying. He is just so difficult to deal with and read his dumb tweets.
But he's like anybody else in the business. He's trying to get his brand out there, and you guys are critiquing him, you know?
Well,
sorry, he's not slick at it, but it's a brand.
He is the master of self-promotion, the Bobo brand. But now he wants to hitch his Bobo wagon to your star there, Carl. And travel the nation with you. I can picture it, though. Mount Rushmore, the Grand Canyon, all the big attractions around this grand nation of ours. The great arch in St. Louis.
Being sullied forever in everyone's mind.
Oh, God, I couldn't think of one interesting moment that fucking trip would conjure up. It would be the worst thing ever. Oh, Colin. By the way, Colin Quinn, are you changing the name of Unconstitutional? Because I loved the Touche. when he called Unconstitutional the Touche. Oh, is that great?
It's like when he changed Ron Conkman to the Cock.
The Cock.
Yeah,
yes, you are just a bevy of these nicknames that I think could catch on, because the conch did kind of catch on with a lot of people,
the kids specifically.
Carl, you know Long Island, pretty well. Did you see this kid that fucking at the Jets game? That this kid, this guy
at the Jets, that girl, right?
Yeah, he punched the girl in the face. Apparently, when he was 17, he stabbed a guy and killed him and did 3 years in prison for that. And he just looks like one of these typical Long Island dick bags from his yearbook picture with his dumb tuxedo shirt on. He has something called the Jetsmobile that he drives to the games. It's a short bus, but it's painted jet green and white. And
well, maybe he's trying. Yeah, he's trying to replace Fireman Ed. You know,
I think he is. You know what would be great though? Bobo and Colin going cross country in the Jetsmobile.
Yeah.
Now that would be something.
Absolutely.
With that guy.
Imagine Bobo chanting J-E-T-S, Jets, 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 no matter what city you go to.
And the guy who owns the Jetsmobile punching him in the face repeatedly.
That would be, or stabbing him. Yeah. He's been known to do that.
Even
too.
Better.
Yeah, so.
Fucking bottom feeder.
So, Colin, when is this trip supposed to go down? Is it going to be a summer trip?
Well, I'm in Charleston, South Carolina right now, so I'm just kind of like feeling people out about Bobo and my trip, and they seem to be enthusiastic.
Feeling people out. I saw some of your pics on Twitter there. You went to some historic places?
Yes, I've been all over the place.
I saw you were at like an old church and a cemetery, and what are you, looking at some Civil War shit?
Yeah, there's a lot of cool shit down here, man.
Yeah?
Unbelievable.
That is good.
You would love Charles. You ever go down here?
I've never been down there.
There's never a place that Anthony Comey would settle. It would be in this town.
Is Why? That really? Oh, boy.
It's a combination of things that you love.
I know what that means. Probably guns.
You really know.
And complete segregation of the races.
Yeah, it's a combination fucking liquor, gun store, fucking grammar school.
Yeah, those southern states, I've driven through them on my way to Florida. That's about it. I've never really stopped off.
Yeah, south of the border. Yeah. Maybe me and Bobo go to south of the border, get him a big sombrero.
That'd be funny. A big sombrero. And you could buy some fireworks.
Yeah.
Shit like that. I'm with you.
And he could light them off while you're dancing in a robe trying to sell coke. He could fucking light them off in the background in his underpants.
I'm there. That was
he's Asian.
I liked your Jeff Foxworthy statue too.
Oh yeah.
Who was that?
Yeah, all the Civil War guys look like Jeff Foxworthy.
You know? Every Civil War guy. It's true. They got that dumb mustache and great head of hair. How's the South doing these days? Are they still holding that grudge against the North? A lot of Southern flags. You don't know?
They love the touche. That's all I'm going to say.
They love the touche. God, do I love that. When are you back in New York with the touche? I want to go see it.
Oh, it's going to be a couple of weeks. But I told you, the beauty of the touche is I'm not going to be in some foolish theater in New York City. I'll be in Bayshore doing it. You can come out there.
Oh, man. Nice.
You know what I'm saying?
Maybe we could punch some women.
It's all going towards, all roads lead to Ronkonkoma.
All roads. The conk. I'm psyched.
Well, all right, guys.
Carl, thank you for the call.
Thank you.
Always a joy hearing from you.
Well, Jimmy, try to remember something.
Yes, that's Carl.
You better get in on the bottom floor with this Bobo Colin tour.
Yeah, maybe. I really shouldn't miss the boat. I mean, it's right here being presented at my feet. I should probably grab this opportunity.
Bye, God.
See you, buddy.
Take it easy, man. Thanks. Should be an app where you could keep track of where they are and everything. That'd be great. Oh, man, is he just fucking feeding Bobo. This nonsense about this car trip.
And Colin doesn't know how dangerous it is. Oh. Colin doesn't realize that he's setting himself up. Like, Bobo is becoming obsessed.
Yeah, yeah.
And Colin is not going to shake Bobo anytime soon.
No!
Like, Bobo is firmly implanted in Colin's life.
Right. That, remember that girl that was here the other day? That Lynn's girl? She was here, the little short girl.
Oh, from Boston, yeah.
Big fucking tits.
Yeah, yeah.
That was here. Apparently, they went to that cancer benefit.
Right.
That Otto and George was at, and Bob Levy, and everything. And she, like, took a picture and was hanging out and kind of talking to Bobo. I told her, I go, it's over.
That's over
for you. He will probably not stop texting you or DMing you and tweeting you.
And you said big tits?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a problem.
Oh, yeah.
Bobo loves him some titties.
Bobo loves big tits.
Oh, yeah, he does.
Fuck, does he love big tits.
Well, because he's not a smart man. So it's just whatever is the obvious there. Like, oh, big tits
right,
is good.
Right. A pinwheel.
Right.
visual things, colors.
If you can start making a balloon animal in front of him and twisting the...
Oh, yeah.
He loves it.
Fascinated.
Yeah.
Fascinated. Let's take a break.
We have two guests coming.
We have two guests, yes. Today, the wonderful John Lithgow will be showing up later on. But first, we have DL.
Which one?
You think Colin's going to enjoy the John Lithgow interview?
I do, actually.
No, Colin bashed us for our interviews.
Oh, I know. I was here when he did.
Yeah, and...
Who listens to him?
Well, I got to be honest. Now, whenever we're doing an interview and I'm asking questions, all I think of is how Colin is assessing my performance.
I wouldn't think of that even if Colin was the guy I was interviewing.
I just can't get it out of my head when I ask a poignant question. I think Colin is sitting there laughing, mocking me.
Well, let him. How about, you know, if it was a guy like Charlie Rose who called up,
I would
say there's something to be said for that.
So you're saying a piece of shit like Colin shouldn't be given.
He's a fucking a sleep-deprived nothing with, like, little skinny camel legs.
All right.
Careful. All right.
He's a cyber bully.
He's a bully. Colin's a bully.
He is a bully.
Okay.
He's mean-spirited.
Mm-hmm. I'll try to remember that. We talk to D.L. Hughley next, I gather.
I guarantee you D.L. smells good, too.
Always.
Yeah. I always get great cologne ideas from D.L.
You love the way the guests smell.
Jenna smelled good.
You said Jenna smelled very good. Must have been the tears.
Oh, and?
Girl tears. They smell great. Okay, we'll be back after these words.
Shut up, cunts. It's Bobo time. The Opie and Anthony Show.
Garbage. Want me to bring us back? I'll do it well.
Do it up, Jim.
Welcome back.
Oh, that's nice.
I don't like it.
To the Opie and Anthony Show. Opie, as we said it out today, he has a weird thing where he can't stop leaking pre-seminal fluid, so he's at the doctor's trying to have that fixed. His cum duct, the thing that stops it from leaking is broken, like a fucking reflux flap in your throat.
Stop with this technical jargon. The cum duct.
I thought it was a problem with the vas deferens.
Oh. It might be. The vas deferens is what produces. Opie is an abnormally thick and productive vas deferens.
Yeah. Vas deferens.
He's a big inner cock vein.
Yeah, it's gotten to the point where he keeps falling and slipping in pre-seminal fluid.
Yeah. And his fucking, as we said before, his fucking glazed donut thighs, both of them. Because he'll shift it, like as it leaks down his left leg, and then he'll heft his cock into the right side.
Must be a lot of crust on his leg.
Oh, without a doubt.
Yeah.
Yeah, and his socks began, it hurt, pulled off leg hair. His socks came off, and he had to get something done.
It does. It ends up like fucking rubber cement in your hairs, in your leg. It's terrible.
I guess, okay.
That's what they call terrible. Dr. Steve was tweeting something yesterday about vasectomies and whatnot. Says that the sperm, spermatozoa, is merely 3% of the entire load. So you don't have to worry about, like, smaller loads after you get a vasectomy.
It's all gouge.
A lot of guys are worried about smaller loads.
I was, but I've heard you do have smaller loads.
3%
smaller. 3%
smaller.
What's that?
Yeah.
How much?
What's the fucking that? It's not even a fucking teaspoonful.
Mm-hmm.
Yum, yum. Eat them up. I guess DL is...
He's on his way.
Late, huh?
Mm. Yes, he is late.
All right, just checking.
You know who else is late?
Who?
He's not doing this show.
Who?
Rick Ross is coming up here.
Mm, he's late, too.
The boss.
It's the boss.
Oh. Maybe they're...
he's about 20 minutes late.
They're hanging out.
I want to go meet Rick Ross.
The Bows?
Do you?
Ricky!
What are you going to say?
Hi, Rick.
What's your favorite song?
Yeah. That fucking, the do-do-do. What was that one?
Fine.
Yeah.
Right.
I'll say, truthfully, I don't listen to the music, but I like him.
Are you going to go up to him and just go, my nigga? You should do that. Shake his hand. No?
No.
I think you're allowed to do that now. I think white people are getting more permission to use the A version.
On the websites you go to.
Well, it's not quite the N-I-G-G-A version.
They're progressive.
Right. They keep it, you know, old school, as they say. Right.
I should just walk up and go, what do you, the boss of what company, you know?
You think he'd appreciate that?
He'd probably go, Chipper, you're a nut.
What did he do? Is he another, like,
badass criminal?
No, I think he was a corrections officer.
Yeah, as it turns out, he used to be a corrections officer who stole the name of a very famous drug dealer. However, he spits hot fire, so it's like, what are you going to say?
What do you mean, spits hot fire?
He's very good at rap music.
Oh, he is?
Mm-hmm.
He performs, or does he just...
Of course, yeah.
No, yeah, he's a rapper.
See, I don't know anything about the rap community.
He's a recording artist.
Yeah?
Yep.
What's with the Godfather font?
He's the fucking Baus.
The Baus.
That's right.
Now, I assume that's a take on the boss.
That's how he says it, yeah.
I'm the Baus.
I interviewed him once when 50 Cent was making fun of him.
You did.
And I asked him if it hurt his feelings when 50 Cent bought his baby mama coat.
Oh, that's right.
And then he said, no, that's the highest compliment you could give to a Baus. And then he started calling 50 Cent and his management team monkeys.
Oh,
is that amazing that he didn't get broken by that, though?
Not even close.
I mean, he's a...
Ja Rule's career was ended by 50 Cent shitting on him.
Was it?
Yeah.
Yeah, and Rick Ross has never been more successful.
Amazing.
Do you think that is he a more respected rapper than 50 Cent?
Rick Ross? Yeah. Right now, definitely.
I guess he doesn't want to get in any beef with Bruce. So that's why he says the Baus instead of Boss.
You think he's worried about Springsteen?
He's very worried about a Bruce beef.
He wants New Jersey to still have love for the Baus.
Exactly. So he says the Baus and leaves the Boss to Bruce.
There are rumors that his beard is stuck on.
What do you mean? Like fake?
Red Band from Joe Rogan's podcast showed me a video of this thing that I didn't even know was happening. And I try to stay up on the community.
Sure.
But in black barbershops, there's this process.
The barbershop?
The barbershop. There's this process of you can go in as a man and have a beard stuck to your face. That's why so many of these beards look so clean cut. I swear to God, there's videos.
That's fucking silly.
There's videos of guys getting these beards put on, and people are saying that Rick Ross's beard may be stuck on.
So much like when chicks, black chicks fight and weaves get left in the street.
Yes.
You mean to tell me soon we may be seeing errant beards laying in the road due to black guys fighting?
If it comes to fisticuffs, somebody may end up losing a beard.
That'd be funny. Like, oh, shit, he pulled off his beard. World star.
Right.
Yeah, that does look fake, that beard.
Let me see it.
Look, how long it's very big.
He's had it forever.
He's got an afro on his chin.
Right. You could do that in the new GTA. You could go to the barbershop with the black character.
Yeah. You don't got to tell me.
Can you open a picture and zoom in on it?
Only have played the black characters in GTA.
Have you changed him at all, like the way he looks?
Oh, hells yeah, yo.
Mine has like a small Ice Cube afro and a big Rick Ross beard.
I went with the 80s kind of fade.
Yeah.
I don't think I went with facial hair. But yeah. It's just, I got to give it to the black people. It is so much fun to go to the rich white neighborhoods in GTA 5 as the black character and just punch white people in the face as you walk down the street. Because they don't fuck with you.
No.
If you go to the ghetto area in GTA 5 and punch one of the brothers in the face, he'll pull a gun out or a knife and start fucking you up. But the white people in the white neighborhoods, they run in fear and then you just stomp them.
I did the most amazing thing in GTA 5 that I didn't even know was possible over the weekend. It changed my life.
What'd you do?
You know how if you really want to get the cops on you, you drive onto the tarmac at the airport, and the cops get furious.
You're instant fucking at least 4 stars, right?
Yeah. So what I did was I drove onto the tarmac.
Oh, boy.
And there was a private plane driving on the tarmac, getting ready to take off.
Oh, shit.
So I drove my car up to it, jumped out of the car, and jumped on the wing of the plane.
Come on.
They stopped the plane, and the pilot gets out. I jumped in the plane.
Oh, man, you jacked the fucking plane.
And I took off away from the cops. I took off in the plane. And then I flew that shit into a bridge.
You're a terrorist,
yeah.
Sam Roberts. D.L. Hughley.
What's that, man?
What's happening, man?
D.L., who looking does sharp, smell good.
Looking sharp, per usual. Yeah, that's
per usual. Opie is out today.
Yeah.
He decided Tuesdays... can go fuck themselves. That's what he says. Well, Jimmy, you were accurate.
Yeah, I said you always smell good.
Smells good.
You're a very good smelling man.
Damn.
I bought a couple of colognes on DL's recommendation.
Did you?
Absolutely.
Somehow it just doesn't have the same effect.
No, it doesn't. It's nice knowing that it has potential.
Jimmy, it doesn't matter what you put on, you stink.
Yeah, I know.
Not at all.
They say it's chemistry.
Is it? Yeah, yeah. Yeah. That's like you watch some of the shows on Discovery Channel, whatever, right, where they put together a fucking steel belt of radial tires, right, and stuff. I've watched those dumb shows, and you see like these fragrance places, and it affects the body heat, the chemistry that comes off of you.
They did a survey thing where they made men, they played basketball, they ran, then they took a handkerchief and they wiped their underarms by their pubic hairs and put it in their pocket like a pocket square, and the women always like that more.
Holy shit.
By that standard, women should dig taxi drivers.
Yeah, right. Well, I don't think Swamp Ass was on that. Maybe a few dabs of the male musky shit, but
this smells like I'm running from a rebel tribe. Yeah.
Sometimes you get in a fucking cab, and it's just, and I know we've done this, people have done this 1,000 times, but it's distracting for the entire ride. Right. You can't do anything but concentrate on the stench that is in that friggin' vehicle.
Like, remember when we had the Arab Spring, a couple of years ago?
Yes, yes.
I'm like, it ain't nothing like Irish Spring.
No. No, I don't think it's as fresh as spring.
There are certain colognes you want to smell good with. There's one I wear that I get a lot of compliments on every time I wear it. That's a mouthwash. and then there's other ones that I wanted, and I just, they smell good. I like them, but nobody comments on them. But this one cologne, I just have as much.
But that's the only ones you wear. You wear when a woman says that. What is that?
Yeah.
Does it make you want to fuck me, or is that?
Yeah.
Because that's what you're going for.
Now I'll just wear it all the time.
Yeah. I should stop trying to fucking one up myself and just take the one. Getting obsession and fucking Dracar Noir and polo, trying to recapture my high school glory days.
Dracar Noir. What are you, Persian?
Dracar was big for a while.
It was
though.
A huge.
That was a big one.
Lagerfeld.
Yes. It was CK1.
Dracar was so good. It was in those little vending machines in the bathroom.
After a while.
Get that.
That's when you know you're like, this is cool roast. This is going too far.
Fucking high karate.
Now you remind me of my father. This smells like I'm going to get my ass whipped when I get home.
There was always, I remember as a kid, you walk into the bathroom and your dad's shit is just fucking all over the sink. Brute. And just, Brut by Fabergé and the old razor and fucking the little cup with a thing to mix up the foam. Right. What is this, 1850?
Some sarsaparilla.
But it was always like a mysterious thing as a kid. You'd look at that those adult friggin' bathroom things and be like, oh man,
I can't wait to get this done.
I gotta shave.
We had my mother would only wash, like, she only washed all our clothes together, and it was me, my brother, my father, and all the she washed everybody's underwear again.
Oh, but yeah.
So you had to rush to the basket. Sometimes he got ours, and sometimes we got
it. Shit.
Sometimes they were so big they were hanging on.
Giving no support.
Sometimes you just had to go. You had to rush to the basket because the good ones.
She wouldn't separate.
No
fold.
Yeah, none of that shit.
None of that shit. Right.
Go get you.
You're lucky I washed it, you motherfucker.
right. And then everybody had jackets. All of us had jackets. Like a big family. All of us walking around a little circle. On the,
Jesus Christ.
It was fucking on. And then they take the underwear and use them after they get so old nobody can use them. Then they use them for like dust cloths.
A dust cloth. Yeah. So you could pledge the fucking furniture.
Oh, shit. I'd never go back to that shit again.
I don't think. Do people even do that anymore? Like, I remember my mom would, like, Saturday morning, she would freak out and be like, this place looks like a bomb hit it. We'd run around looking over our shoulders like fucking urchins. Right. Like fucking Oliver Twist. And, dusting was a big part. You vacuum, you dust, you do the dishes. Right. And, like, you'd sit there and just spray the fucking pledge. And does anyone do that anymore? Do kids have to do that?
Mm-mm.
I think, like, furniture now is self-cleaning or some shit.
Pledge smells good. No matter what happened in your house, fucking Pledge smelled fucking great. Yeah. You had a body store at the corner. If you pledge the table, the fucking place
and
was fantastic.
And Pine Sol. It always,
Pine Sol,
I think they
yeah.
always made fragrances that made it look like you cleaned some shit that you did.
Right. You could
it
really
smells like it's clean.
A half-assed job, and right. at least it, like, wow, this place is clean.
What's the one for all wood? It's not Pledge. There's another one that's for
Murphy's.
Murphy's
Oil.
Oil.
Soap. Well, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, but that never does it for me. I don't like that stuff.
Yes. No?
No, I like Pledge.
They don't have the... I don't even... I can't remember last time I saw...
I don't remember what the Mexicans use at my house. They come through like a fucking brown tornado. Just clean all that shit up and smell great.
Oh, like my we had the same lady named Marlene for 20-some years, right? And she's from Guatemala. But my wife, one day, made this big Cinco de Mayo dinner.
Ooh.
And she's like, I don't... know what the fuck this is.
Oh,
like,
shit.
She's Guatemala.
She assumed.
This is fucking horrible, huh?
I don't know. Anything south of Texas, probably all eat the same shit anyway. I don't know.
It was, man, I had the worst experience Friday, man. I'm at a gig, and you know how people come back after the gig and they're talking. And I was trying to be fucking charming. And so this girl's like, I'm talking to her. She's cute. And I go, what the fuck is wrong with you? Are you slow? And she said, I had a stroke. And I said,
oh, my God.
I said, she didn't have no goddamn stroke. Start with the bullshit. And her friend said, she really did have a stroke. And I went, oh, my God, I'm so sorry.
Oh,
I'm so sorry. I'm
that's
so sorry.
A bad move right there.
I said, can I buy you a drink? I'm so sorry. She said, no, it'll mess up my medication. I was like, fuck this shit. Was,
on medication, too?
She was young, though. She was.
Oh,
she had
man.
30?
That's a shame. Did she look good?
She did. She was cute. Cute. And then, and then it gets worse. So then after it's over... we're waiting for her car to...
she forget a wooden leg?
Oh, my God. So I had to... she couldn't... they let her friends, like, leave her to go get the car, and she's standing up front. She's on... so I had to hold her up by her hand that had the...
oh, shit.
Oh.
And just feeling like shit the whole
the
time.
The whole time. I mean, she was so sweet. That. She was so sweet. And I was like, why didn't I see? Because I could only see from this side of her face.
Yeah. Well, you probably wouldn't assume at that age, you know.
Yeah.
Something. What made you say, are you slow?
Because
just the way
she was just,
talking?
Like, she left like, hur, hur, hur.
But, like why laugh. Would you even say that?
Because, right. like, here's why. 999 times out of 1,000, it's just a girl with a goofy laugh, right. And her friends will go, he picked the one
that,
stroke.
That weren't it. That time weren't it.
Right, that
holy
wasn't it.
Shit. Oh. I pulled a faux pas once. A guy I worked with, we left work to go for lunch. And I get in his car in the passenger seat, and I go to click the seatbelt. And the fucking thing is at the end of the fucking belt.
Right.
Like, you can't let out anymore.
Right.
And I was like, who's the fat piece of shit that was sitting here? And it was his mom. He goes, oh, my mother. She, and I'm like, oh, sorry, man. He's like, no, it's okay. You know, she's big. I'm like, oh, I called his mom a fat piece of shit.
You can have a fat ass mother. Like,
yeah,
if it was
but
his girlfriend.
No one wants to hear that your mom's a fat ass. Yeah. You could know it. You could accept it. You know that your friends know it.
Right.
But you don't want to hear him say. Your mom's
like so
fat.
In such in with a lot of venom in it.
I
who's
did too.
Fat
I was like, who's the fat piece of shit? That's what I said, piece of shit.
Ooh.
That there and then it's like, what makes you pop shit out like that? The common one is, you know, when's the baby due?
Right.
I guess Brian Regan does that bit. It's like you try to take it back as you're saying it. When's the baby due? Just flies out of your mouth. Yeah, yeah. Somebody said that in here. Oh, the taco lady. Remember she had like a gut on her.
Yeah.
And I wasn't sure if maybe she was, you know, getting high on her own supply or she was pregnant. I didn't say anything. And then I guess Opie just turned around, of course, Mr. Charm. So who went to the baby too.
Ooh.
And everyone just went like winced. And she said, you know, a few months or whatever. And we were like, oh, boy.
Oh,
Christ.
Was,
yeah, she actually was
she's Latin, right?
Pregnant. Yeah.
Yeah, well,
so
you
assume
can say that anytime.
She's always pregnant.
Yeah,
baby already had its ears pierced.
So what are you, a rabbit?
In utero. They're doing in utero ear piercings in the Latin community these days. and tattooing on eyebrows.
Look, I can tell it's a boy. How come? Because it's holding a little leaf blower.
I
get horrible when I come here.
I thought it's something ridiculous. Terrible when, because of course, again, Hispanic gentlemen do my yard work also.
No.
Yeah, Go figure that one out, right?
We used to have Asian dudes.
Asian guys?
Yeah.
I hear they're pretty good.
Yeah, but they're very expensive.
They just nip every tree down to 3 feet tall.
Like, look at Mr. Miyagi. Just plant on one bonsai tree.
It's like I fucking had a big weeping willow here, and now it's a little fucking bonsai.
Just trim down the oleander. I don't need...
Bring you luck. Yeah, great. Great. Yeah, and then he had one of those, the backpack on with the blower.
Yeah.
And he's going around, and I thought, it's like I couldn't get out of my head to call him Buck Rodriguez. Yeah, looked like a little rocket pack. Come on, it's funny.
It's hilarious.
It was, you know, I still call him that.
That's
tell all my friends.
Oh, when he leaves away. Oh, it's just.
I know.
It's certain shit you just have to do. I don't, you know, in California they had. The leaf blowers, they banned them because they were so loud.
Yeah, they're loud, and they're all over.
Right.
Like, every yard. Yeah.
But they didn't realize that that really stops, cuts down the number of gardeners that you have around.
Uh-huh.
So, like, a leaf blower can take up the space of 3 people. So then they didn't have a leaf blower, so just the place was a lot of Latin.
Yeah, yeah. Around. Now, they got to pull the rakes out and do it old school?
You have to do it.
I don't care what modern technology they bring back there. Gets them out of there faster. There you go.
They banned it legally?
Yeah.
California's weird, man.
It is.
They make up all these wacky laws.
Yeah, you can't have... No, now, in Calabasas where I live, you can't have plastic.
My...
You have to bring your own paper bag. We have to bring your own bag when you go to the store.
Oh, right, to the store?
You can't smoke outside. Like, if you smoke in the common areas, you can get a $200 ticket.
So you're just supposed to smoke at home?
And now they're trying to ban where you can't even smoke at home.
Yeah, I think if you live in an apartment,
condos,
they're trying to stop
it's
condos.
No, there's no condos there.
No.
And like, I live in the same neighborhood as Justin Bieber. So. Like,
oh, okay.
And he's fucked up to the whole neighborhood because now police are in.
Right.
He made the neighborhood. He blew up the spot. Now it's all hot. I had a neighbor that got a DUI one house down from his house. Like one. I don't know why he didn't fucking just drive in his driveway and get it, open the garage and close the garage and run the house.
I've seen that in Cops. Don't work.
No. But that, what they gonna? We gonna follow me? Cause I.
That's true. If you go, well, they probably would. You better hope that garage door comes down like one of those fucking Star Wars doors.
I just ran, and then he talked to his lawyer and he said, "Why didn't you just go in the house and then they couldn't find you till you came down?"
Yeah, come out fucking 8 hours later.
Right. I didn't know you were behind me, officer. I
drinking
your
coffee.
Right.
How are you doing, man?
Right.
What's up, sir?
If they're in speed, but then they would say they were in pursuit and you were evading a police officer.
But they weren't. Well, shit.
That is true. I've seen, like, where they've been pursuing people on Cops and the guy is near his house and he pulls in the driveway, runs out and runs in his house. Oh, boy, they follow him right the fuck in there.
Yeah.
Not even a knock.
They're not going to follow an old white man in his house.
Well, that's true.
Not in Calabasas. They would have.
Yeah, they probably leave him. Okay.
They would have done. But that motherfucker.
He looked okay.
Right.
Let's go.
He was home already.
Let's go see what DL's up to down the road.
What's the point of giving somebody a DUI when they're pulling in their fucking driveway?
That's true. He made it.
It's like Ali and Free.
I made it. Home. I'm at base.
Right.
I'm at home base. So Unless you have a patent leather shoe in your grill, then perhaps further investigation is necessary.
Is that blood?
Jimmy is getting a picture and an autograph right now. He was very excited. Jimmy will leave the program for these things. He left, who did we have in here?
Tony Danza.
We had Tony Danza, the incredible Tony Danza was in here. And
from Texas.
Jimmy left.
And who was the boss?
Yeah.
Right.
And the amazing Tony Danza show, if you remember that talk show he had for a little while.
Is amazing the word?
Well, you don't remember it either.
He had bangs, right?
Tony Danza had sort of a kind of
like Christy McNichol in Eight Is Enough.
Christy McNichol bangs. Yeah, Tony Danza was rocking the bangs quite a while. What happened there, Jim?
I just want to take a quick photo.
Did you get it?
Yeah.
Oh, was he cordial?
Skinny, man.
Thanks, Theo.
Didn't he?
Yeah, he was very friendly.
How did that? How much you lose?
It's funny. I went to my doctor yesterday, and I said, "What was the heaviest I was?" And she said, "Right now, I'm coming out with clothes on at 153."
Wow.
But she said I was in 2011. I was 176, and 173 last year. So, and there was one point I can remember being 180.
You lost 20 pounds in a year.
Than 20, probably almost, but between 24 and 27 pounds.
Damn.
Just going to the gym and eating better.
Go to the gym and eating better.
I just ate better, and I do a lot of, I have four sessions a week with trainers.
Mm. You ain't bullshit. You trying to live, huh?
Fuck yeah, but shit, you still can't get rid of this. This that's fucking, right. This mush under the, yeah. It's impossible.
That's all right. You still, you'll be around
it's,
longer.
Yeah.
You'll be fucking around longer.
That's the, you got to probably lipo that out.
I don't know if I do or not, because it doesn't feel like, I know my eating is not perfect, and I know if I ate better, I should be swimming every day. If I swam every day for 3 months, I'll bet you that this would be
yeah,
a
yeah, but
big
then
day.
You would.
Go for a swim?
You weigh 153 and you're a grown man. And you're not from, you know, a third world country.
Yeah.
You're doing it on purpose. So, fuck it. Just, you don't want to be that.
No, I just want this gush gone. I don't care. Like, when I still wear no shirt, I still look like Jim from a few years ago. But just, it's like I didn't muscle up. I just shrunk. It was almost like somebody took a picture of me.
So now he wants a little vanity.
A little vanity.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, instead of looking better, I feel like someone took a fat photo of me and then zoomed away from it.
Yeah. No, you look great, Jimmy.
Yeah, thank you.
He's doing
it makes you look younger, too, when you lose weight.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah, my trainer noticed I was doing some reps, and she goes, "Oh, your chest is coming in." I was
like, oh, shit. Right, right.
Well, thank you.
Wow.
Is she a nice-looking trainer?
Extraordinarily sexy.
You got right. Girl trainers.
Extraordinarily. Oof. I get zero vibes. Nothing. Zero.
It's like nothing.
Zero.
No, just give me the money and yeah. Do your crunch.
Yeah.
You like the female trainer?
Oh, yeah. I don't want a male. I don't want male energy.
No,
I don't want
no,
a guy in between no. Reps. So what do you do? No. Ugh. No. Shut up.
That's hard. You know what I'm doing? It's this place called SLT here.
Mm-hmm.
And it's one in Midtown. And one. It's, you would think Pilates was crazy, but it's the most intense. Like, it's strength training, Pilates, and cardio all in one thing.
Oh,
so
man,
it's 15
yeah.
minutes. But it's all these young, white, lean, dancer type.
Oh, shit.
And they're doing all this. I'm like, man, fuck this. I don't I'll do two crunches and then it.
Yeah, and I'm done.
But it's I'm telling you, it's the best thing I've ever. It's,
yeah.
Yeah, 15 minutes. I do it four times a week.
Damn, 15 minutes. That's it. 50. Okay.
But you know how like you have to do weights or and then you'll have to do cardio. This is all
yeah,
one thing.
Yeah. Wow.
They're like almost bondage machines. They're like
you've seen them?
BDS. I've taken a little bit of Pilates. But I preferred the mixing up that a trainer gives me. But Pilates
right.
is really good.
Yeah, but it's not, I'm telling you, it's not on that little machine. It's like called a mega reformer, and it's just, why are we sitting there? We're talking about fitness now.
I know, right?
It's taking a horrible turn here.
You can, though. I saw a picture that Joe Rogan posted yesterday, and he's lifting a fucking kettlebell that was like
yeah.
a cannonball.
Yeah.
Fucking like just, yeah, fucking... Getting into the, you know, he uses these fucking words that makes it sound like it's yeah. amazingly fun.
Yeah.
Look how that I just retweeted it and put pussy.
Right. Look how that worked out for Joe Piscopo.
Yeah.
I'm so in shape.
Yeah, yeah.
Nobody wants yeah. a sexy comedian.
No.
Nobody wants. Rogan pulls off being muscular and stuff because
yeah.
he's in the fight game.
Yeah.
And so it works.
Right, like right.
UFC thing.
Yes. Yep. But nobody wants a sexy. That to me is when comics are in trouble. But like when you start wearing leather shirts and wearing them open on stage, you're right. in deep trouble right. as a performer.
Oh, you don't think that works?
No.
You gotta be.
It does for a while though.
Can be the outcast.
For a while, then everybody goes, "This guy's a dickhead."
Yeah, it's just,
it does for a while.
Yeah.
People are afraid to play the fool or to be the foil or whatever the term would be.
Right.
When they think they're sexy.
Yes, it's not. You're not. You can't be self-deprecating.
Right.
You can't.
Huh.
I don't want a comic up there telling me like it is. And,
right.
Oh, shut up.
Right.
You know?
You don't
so,
like that?
That's so fucking boring.
What?
So boring. Because there's enough good-looking guys in real life to do that.
Oh,
I don't
right,
even got
yeah.
a comic who I know right. fucking hates his own guts as much as I do.
You want him to be a piece of shit up there?
Yes, yeah. Be yourself. You're up there tap dancing for and doing little jokes. You're the same fucking emotionally desperate idiot I am.
But black guys can get away with it more.
Well, you know,
when
you just
watch,
can't
like
I don't like people who like themselves.
Yeah?
Like, I just don't, if you like yourself a lot,
right?
I don't trust you.
The way fucking Eddie Murphy would come out, though, and Chris Rock and shit.
Though.
I know, that's just it. You know, he could get away with shit like that. I think black comics, good-looking black comics, can get away with it a lot more than white comics can.
It's, at a certain point, it still becomes, like, when you start digging yourself a lot on stage, you can tell.
You can tell.
You can tell when a cat digs himself.
Sure.
Yeah, yeah.
You're like, you don't, it's not fun.
Kevin Hart right now, I know, blows a kiss at the mirror and winks before he walks on. But,
yeah.
But Kevin's act is that he makes fun of his
right.
family and himself and he's a short,
right,
grown
right.
man. He's at least, he's self-deprecating
right.
in his act, so
right.
that's probably why it works.
Uh-huh.
Murphy, as great as he was, I think the first special was better than the second one.
Right.
And the second one, when he had the open leather, he was already a movie star.
Right.
He didn't do another special after that.
Well, that's true. Yeah.
With gloves on.
With gloves, yeah. With
fucking gloves.
Yeah. But I think everybody else since that, every other black comic since that, saw that. And it does a derivative of it.
Uh-huh.
With a leather shirt. Like, just
yeah, that. Yeah, yeah. And then at the end, you got to do the... throw the mic on the fucking stage.
Gotcha.
And you're off.
Gotcha.
He was the coolest motherfucker on stage with those specials.
When I first saw him, when I was, we didn't know who he was. Like, I grew up in L.A., so I didn't know who he was. But I remember, I want to see that funny nigga on Saturday Night Live. Who is that?
Who is that?
and then one time, when Delirious came out, then that's the first time I ever put the name with it. He was so, like, last night I was out to dinner, right? And Jamie Foxx was there.
Uh-huh.
And when I first, we were working together at the Comedy Act Theater. And when I first saw him on stage, he could do, impersonations, he could sing, he could, and I remember turning to another comic, Joe Torre, and I said, how the fuck is one dude that talented?
I hate that shit.
And all I can do is tell jokes, and this motherfucker can do impressions and sing.
What happened to Joe Torre? He hosted Def Jam for a while after,
He still grinds.
I never knew him.
Yeah, he still grinds out there, but it's just... You when you grow up seeing these cats, and I think everybody getting back to it was influenced by Eddie. They
right,
kind of wanted to
fuck
look like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Except by picking up transvestites.
Because everybody has their foibles.
I give them rides as well. You may be selfish with your car, but I'm not.
Rides.
Young lady needs a lift and a few bucks. Here you are, madam. God bless. Godspeed.
Is that a dick?
No, you don't even question it. That's rude. You know what I mean? If somebody fucking coughs and they have like a little spittle on their mouth, you don't question it. You just let it be there.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That's the way it is.
Embarrassing to mention it.
But Pryor never thought he was sexy. Like, you know, Pryor dressed well and he dressed nicely.
Right.
And we're, you know, but he never, it was never a sexy vibe from him.
And he always looked afraid.
Always.
Like he always looked scared
the
whole time.
Wow, yeah.
Did you see the documentary where they showed the footage, and I had not seen that, of him not doing well on the Sunset Strip special? Fuck, was that uncomfortable.
My daughter, my 26-year-old daughter called me. This happened, because that was on about a year ago, right? Maybe
not even, I think. That was more than 6 months.
She calls me and goes, crying.
Oh.
Now I understand you, and I know you did the best you could. I'm like, what the fuck you mean?
Oh,
you know,
shit.
I did the best I could. I didn't, like, snort cocaine off white women in front of you. What the fuck are you talking about? She's like, I'm not damaging. Oh, man, it was a horrible thing. I was like, what the fuck are you talking about?
That's a great documentary, by the way. It really gives you a good insight on
what a horrible,
was
like,
about.
It has to be. You know how you ever... You ever been high and you're like, am I gonna be like this forever? Like you, like high, you go, I'm trapped. I've gone too far.
Oh shit!
It must have been like that for him all the time. Like not the high part, but just being trapped in your own head.
Yeah.
Doing whatever he wanted. He had much money to buy as much as he wanted. Like no one ever told him no.
No. That's boy, that's a problem. When no one can tell you, one tells you, no one's there to tell you no.
No.
Ugh, and you have unlimited resources.
And you kind of want people to. You kind of like want somebody to do something.
Yeah.
Like you want
to,
but you don't know how to ask for it.
How do you fucking get to the point where you want to burn yourself?
Did you see and I've talked about this on the show before, where like, you know, I idolized Pryor and didn't know him. But the one video I've seen that was probably the true depiction of what he was like to be around was that interview he did on the set of Stir Crazy when they were done filming, and it was just with this guy who was a school teacher, and they had shot in the morning, and I think there was an audio problem, so they had to reshoot in the afternoon. So the guy came back and was re-interviewing Pryor on his lunch break, and as you could tell, it was outside by a trailer, and there's a little audience, you could just tell by the laughs and the way. But Pryor apparently had tipped a few back or was high.
Right.
And you could see in that interview, he was a difficult fucking
guy.
He was really a hard guy. But he was so smart and so... it was like rapid fire. And he was drunk and obnoxious, but funny and charming, and then not funny and charming.
Wow.
And the thing about cats like that is that they're so charming, this charming spike so high that when they are fucked up, you almost go, okay, this he's built up enough equity in this that he can spin
around.
Man.
He could be a little bit of a fucking douche.
Man. But most comics, when you talk to them, are fucked up people.
Oh, yeah.
It's weird.
They make you feel good about, like, I realize I'm fucked up, but I like to be around people that are more fucked up than me, so I can feel
good about yourself.
Like, all right.
I'm not that fucked up.
Oh, Jesus.
Yeah, I'm fucked up, but look at this motherfucker. He's fucked up.
Do Gene Wilder, I saw talk at the 92nd Street Y. We went, me and Sam went,
yeah.
And then Pryor came up. And he said, I think he said, what did they say when you think of Pryor? What do you? And he said, wasted talent, or wow. like waste. Like he loved him. He said when he was good, he was really good. And when he was bad,
wow,
he was bad.
Damn, like, so he could have been better.
Right?
That's
yeah.
even more fucked up. He could have been, Jesus.
On movie sets, he probably wasted a lot of time. You could tell Gene Wilder did not enjoy their time together, because Pryor was a little bit difficult.
Mm.
Yeah, but I bet. Well, Gene Wilder wouldn't be Gene Wilder without Richard Pryor.
Oh, without a doubt. Uh-huh. But I mean, just as a guy, he doesn't look at Pryor the way we do.
Yeah.
He doesn't look at him like he's God. He's just like the asshole that was an hour late again.
Right. Right.
Yeah.
The guy who was, without a doubt, he wouldn't. But, you know.
Because he was his Dean Martin to Jerry Lewis. I mean, that was. He was.
But Wilder probably knew that. So now he's like, I'm depending on this guy for my career.
Right.
And now
he can't defend himself.
Yeah.
Like, literally now, he can't.
Right, yeah.
What is he going to say? I don't know. I never, whenever I saw Richard Pryor, whoever was with him, I never even paid attention to. Even when I was a kid, I never knew what it was about him, but I always knew that whatever he was doing was more important
than ever anyone else on the screen. Him. Yeah.
Now, did you know him?
Oh, yeah, I met him a bunch of times, but he was never, he was really always, like, you could tell he loved you. Ever seen somebody love a thing so much that even the people who do it, they give a certain amount of, even the young cats that do it, they give a certain amount of, you know, all right, let's see what this cat is all about. He was like that. He was like deference. Like,
wow.
So it was,
yeah.
But seeing him, because the comedy scene here was much different than LA. All our shit was, you could either go to the Comedy Store, which they didn't let niggas go to, or you could go to the Comedy Act Theater. And that was real. And then everybody would finish going to the Comedy Store and they'd come down to the Comedy Act Theater. And that's how you saw everybody.
Huh.
I've never played the Comedy Store.
Oh, really?
Really? Never?
Never.
Huh.
Never.
Whose choice is that?
Well, first they wouldn't let me play.
Right, but right. Now,
like, I remember the first time I ever got booked at a mainstream room was a Cleveland Improv. And they said, it was right after Def Jam. Because they had that thing where, oh, he's a Def Jam cop. Mm-hmm. Right. So we were playing a gig. They booked me and they said, we won't give him any money, but we'll give him a door deal.
Jesus.
And so he can have 90% of the door.
So 90%? Yeah, wow. Yeah.
And they let me, and they added like shows, and they charged, because they charged black people high ticket prices even back then. They'll never pay a serious nigga. So.
Oh, Jesus.
So I was in the ticket office counting the money, going, this is a great deal, man. This is a great deal. And he was livid, so then they booked me. But after that, you know, because they didn't think. I remember being in Charlotte, and the guy says, we were playing a gig in Charlotte, Charlie Goodnight's years ago, and he goes, "They only when you're a black comic doing that time, you could work Tuesdays and Wednesdays, because they would have, you know, the weekend for the other guys, or you could work a Sunday." So my week consisted of Tuesdays and Wednesdays, or a Sunday, Monday somewhere. Like I was a fucking airport worker. But he came out and he said, well, you have to, it was in Raleigh, North Carolina. He said, you have to sign this that you're not going to talk about any of the white people in the audience. I'm like, fuck that.
Are you kidding me?
What the fuck is that about?
I said, no, I'm not going to
sign. You're not, why?
Yeah, I don't get why.
Because it was something they had against Def Jam. I mean, a lot of it, well, obviously, you know, it was kind of perception. But I said, I'm not signing. He said, well, you're not going on stage. I said, well, you tell these two shows I got to go home. And then he did it.
Jesus.
Yeah.
You're not going to make fun of the white people.
Yeah, you got to sign it.
Make sure you use the colored bathroom,
right,
too.
Right.
Don't. Wow.
They didn't have that.
They didn't go that far?
They didn't go that far.
What did he assume? Like, it was going to be, you white people crazy.
Right, I guess he did.
Yeah,
I guess he did.
Uh-huh.
I said, I'm not doing it. But it was something he made everybody sign.
Uh-huh.
So,
where'd they shoot Def Jam?
Here.
It was, but where?
What was it? It's on the same street as the Paramount Hotel. It was
40-something, 40. Oh, I don't know.
It's right across from the Paramount Hotel.
Was it a 500 seat or 1,000 seats?
I might have been 1,000.
I was there once, because I was there when Voss did it.
Uh-huh.
And my greatest moment is when we interviewed Russell Simmons, and Voss was the first white guy that did Def Jam, and Russell Simmons had no idea who he was.
Oh, God.
I've never
funny.
Been happier to hear, and I non-recognized.
Yeah.
Wow, Russell was just churning out talent. Just didn't, never met you. He'd just stand up like the Pope.
Yeah. I don't know what this is. I don't know who that is.
Thank you for coming.
Is.
God bless. Good night.
Right.
That was it. Yeah.
Right.
Same thing every night. Yeah, that.
And they would do all day. They would do shows all
really?
Day. They would do 1, 3, 5, 7, 9 all day.
Wow.
Different crowds.
Well, they do two shows with the same crowd, so it'd be the crowd would have to be there 4 hours. But that was
how many times did you do it?
Five.
Oh, okay.
Five, but
I was from, you know, I was from L.A., so they flew me out to New York, and they gave you a hotel room, and they gave you, I said, I had a thing on my hotel bill that said per diem, and it said $150, and I went, I didn't order per diem. I actually went and said,
oh, no. I didn't order the per diem.
I don't order the
per diem. I'm not paying for this shit.
And she said, no, sir, that's a credit, and that's yours.
Oh.
And I went, oh, well, fuck
it. In that case, give me another.
Yeah, yeah. I had no idea what that shit meant. I was like, you get it. What is that? What does it mean?
Per day.
It's per day.
Oh, shit. What are you promoting, Mr. DL?
I'm doing, I forgot I am here. I'm doing
a game show
on TBS that Mark Barnett did.
Right. I've seen many, spots for that.
If you watch baseball, you saw me.
Promoting
or Tyler Perry show.
Or Seinfeld.
Or Seinfeld. Reruns.
True.
Okay. Maybe you went another direction.
I went in a totally another direction there. Yeah,
so me and Michael Ian Black are co-hosts on the show called Trust Me, I'm a Game Show Host. And it's like an edgy nighttime.
They got to figure out who's bullshitting, right?
Yeah.
Who's lying?
But you know, Mark Burnett, who did Survivor, The Voice. Well, the English, didn't we beat them in a war?
I know, right?
It's not the Mexicans we got to worry about taking over.
No,
it's the English.
They are uber successful.
They're getting
us
back one reality show at a time,
right? Yeah, it's always like, oh, here's my new show.
Man, and this dude, when he walked in, he was tanned, and smart, and bright white teeth, and he throws his keys on his Bentley on the car, and he runs his hair through his hair. I'm like, this motherfucker is rich.
That's just rich guy shit.
He's like, no, this is all wrong. It's all wrong. Like, just, he walked in. It got brighter when this motherfucker walked in. I was like, oh. And
oh,
so
shit.
He had this idea for the show for 10 years. Mm-hmm. It's basically, he tells us, Michael Ian Black will say a fact, and I'll say a fact, and you pick the one who you believe. But it's some really obscure shit. It's not like, you know, Jeopardy.
Like, so, you have an example that you can...
Like, he might say cold weather makes your fingernails grow. And I might say Oprah Winfrey and Elvis Presley are distant relatives.
Mm-hmm.
And you pick. So which one would you think it is?
I would have to go with the fingernail one.
It's not.
It's Oprah and...
I would go with that, because if you trace them back far enough, as a species, we all connect somewhere.
Well, right.
That's probably closer than...
Or they... We probably, at some point, owned her family.
Maybe. Oh, God.
At some point.
Yeah, maybe the colonel.
Somebody owns them.
Oh, you think maybe the colonel stuck his dick in somewhere?
Maybe the colonel had a little shit going on there.
It's called Trust Me, I'm a Game Show Host, and it's on tonight, actually, on TBS. Is it on right before Conan? Conan's on 11, I think.
So it's got to be right
before. So it's 10:30. 9:30 Central. I don't know what time Conan's on Central time, but if you're a Conan fan and you watch, just tune in a half hour early.
Yeah, he's really doing some funny shit these days, Conan.
Yeah.
We played something he did yesterday, which was the montage of these awful newscasters all saying the exact same thing about Mike Myers' baby.
Yeah, yeah.
What happened?
Mike Myers is having a kid, having another baby.
Wow.
And every newscaster started the story by saying, Mike Myers says, yeah, baby. Mm. And it had to be 30.
Yeah.
30 times.
It was terrible.
Different newscasters.
Fallon's doing some great shit, too.
Saying it. Yep. Yeah, yeah. There's definitely, it's like the golden age of late night talk right now, you know?
Arsenio is the same show.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Well, he appears to post an older demo, I think. And Kimmel
they're
and Fallon.
They're not dead, though. Like that. Like, I swear, I'm not kidding. Lamar Odom was on crack, which a crack I've been. Like, how do you even find crack? Like is it like an old copy of New Jack City?
I didn't even think there's crack anymore, right?
So between crack and the Arsenio show, I'm like, when the fuck did we go back to the 80s? What happened? What happened?
Yeah, what happened?
These cats are doing. I think Fallon, Kimmel, Conan, they're doing shit that it's really like cutting edge shit.
Yeah,
And it's all.
It's very relevant. I mean, the way Kimmel uses the internet
is
amazing.
Very
social
smart.
Media. Same thing with Fallon, with using Twitter and getting shit for his show through Twitter.
And the shit he gets people to do.
Yeah. Really clever. Good. It's not only about, you know. having some celebrity come on because they're plugging something. I mean, that was pretty much what Carson was all about. You know, I mean, it was great. Believe me, I love watching Johnny Carson.
But I think he was that for that generation. Like, he was that
absolutely,
for them.
Absolutely. But I think the most everything else seemed like it was kind of an aside to the interviews.
Right.
You know, even though it was very funny.
I think it went, you know, I guess Parr, then Carson. And I think Letterman did some great.
Oh, yeah. Letterman kind of opened that up.
Right. And then for a very long time, nothing. And it took those cats a long time. Like, Kevin's been on a long time.
Yeah.
Yep.
7, 8 years now?
Yeah. Uh-huh.
10 years?
Yeah. It was longer than 10. Probably 12. It's been a long time.
Been that long?
Long, long time. Because Fallon's been on like 8, 7, 6.
No way.
Fallon's been on 5, 6.
Eight. Holy shit. Really?
He's been on a while.
Fuck.
Yeah, and he's. Remember how slow it started? But now it's just like. Oh, yeah.
Now
I have
to
watch that shit.
Yeah. Yep.
I was watching an old Robert Klein special again. Because I own the HBO specials. It was
right.
And I was watching his second one, which I actually haven't seen. It was done in NYU in 1977, and it's fucking. Really good.
1977
was his. He was the first HBO special. Was
really,
and did has done more than anybody else too.
I don't think Carlin has. I could be wrong about that, but I
think he did a special where he took where it's.
Oh, maybe.
I think, he's done the most.
But he Klein was talking in 1977 about guest hosting the Tonight Show again. He's like, yeah, I'm going to guest host, and Johnny had done this and that. And the whole culture, like, you realize those were college-age students, a lot of them, and Carson was their guy. And it was weird to hear Carson referred to. Klein was, like, in his 30s at then, but he was, like, the really hip, smart comic.
Yeah,
and all
these
college students loved him. And you forget that a lot of these older guys, like, they were fucking very hip dudes for a long time.
Yeah, back then, did cocaine in the break room.
Cocaine in the break
room. Like, some of the stories. A friend of mine did a documentary on Paul Williams, the little writer.
Oh, yeah. We've had Paul on a couple of times. He's great.
And I was he just always looked peculiar to me.
Right, of course, yeah. Little midgety guy.
I know you're rich, but you can't write shit at Six Flags. You can't. But anyway, he talked about how he would be hosting these shows and how fucked up everybody would be.
Uh-huh.
Like, you could have a drink. They would have drinks and a little bump before it was.
Yeah, there's a famous clip of Carson where who's Dean Martin and fucking George Goebel is out there and shit, and they got drinks in their hands and cigarettes. They're just smoking and drinking on the show. You can't even fathom something like that. Even a fictional character can't do that on TV now. And back then, they were just like, hey.
But even the shit they talked about wasn't this. And so, like, if you take, to me, the greatest sitcom ever was All in the Family.
Oh, yeah.
And one of the five times I ever heard my father laugh. I've heard my father laugh five times. Four of them were
All in the Family.
Like, he never laughed. So when we heard him laugh, we were running in the house to see what the fuck he was laughing at.
Yeah,
it was always All in the Family. And it was always the most, like, I didn't understand, but always the most racist shit ever.
Yeah.
And it cracked him up.
It was the funniest fucking shit.
Ever.
Yeah.
And imagine if you just, imagine not even the fucking sitcom format aside. If you just read the dialogue. So if me and you got a script and just read some of the dialogue back and forth.
Right. It would be
a fucking controversial.
Outrageous.
I mean, I'm talking about just not change anything, just read.
Just read it verbatim.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I was watching All in the Family the other day, and it was the one where he got the bootleg watch, the Onega instead of the Omega. And he's describing some of the features to Meathead and his daughter and Edith. And he's like, looky here, you could tell what time it is in China. He goes, it's 7 o'clock in China. He goes, you know what that means? 800 million chinks are waking up for breakfast. It's like, you can't say that.
Right.
But they didn't care.
Yeah, the Sandy episode I watched probably 2 days ago, I watched the whole thing.
It's brilliant.
And it's one. You know what made me laugh the hardest in that was when fucking when Lionel is standing there with Mike and Gloria, and Archie goes, "This is my daughter Gloria, and this is her husband Mike." And he reaches out and he shakes hands with Lionel and he goes, "Hi, I'm Mike." And the laugh from the audience, at him thinking that Archie's daughter had married a black guy. Like the laugh from them understanding that was immediate. And how I was like, God, what a great fucking show.
But it was. It was, imagine, you could never imagine a show where we all sat down and watched the same show, like Blacks, White,
yes.
Old.
Uh-huh.
No matter what experience you, like, we grew up with the exact same shows. And right. Not necessarily because a lot of people say, well, they were the only shows on, but they still had to find a way to capture your attention.
Yeah, yeah. Then you just wouldn't watch that show if it wasn't universal.
It
had universal appeal. Now everything's so focused
right.
With a laser to a certain audience.
Right.
They know who they're gunning for, and that's it. But yeah, back then, and I think it was because it was so limited. The options were so limited. You kind of had to make it a...
I
you don't think so?
I think that how the fuck you grew up where you grew up. I grew up in L.A. in the fucking 135th and
right.
But we laugh at we can
same
I can
shit.
Remember so that they might true enough there might not have been many options but they couldn't force us to laugh at the same
right shit. That's true yeah
they couldn't make us laugh at the same
it
shit.
Had to be in the writing
it had to be in the sweet spot
and the yeah
and now nothing like we do a syndicated show now where we're talking about the Preachers of LA
mm-hmm.
Like, and in the black community, the church is the biggest thing ever.
Right.
Like, but only, like, three people go to church. Is black women, the children that we may go with them,
uh-huh.
And the gay dudes who are in the choir. That's really it. Like, because men tend just not to go. Not because apathetic, but just because you're tired of a motherfucker hustling. Right?
Uh-huh.
And so I'm watching this shit on, like, I have to watch the show because I want to be able to talk about it.
Uh-huh, yeah.
But it's just, now, when God needs a reality show from these fucking worthless-ass dudes who are just, it's just gone too fucking far. Like,
uh-huh.
Jesus, you don't need a reality. It was a preacher that got shot in fucking Baton Rouge because he was fucking another man's wife.
Oh, geez.
At a revival. Get that. Oof. He got killed in public. And, you know, every time he turned around, a preacher was giving HIV to kids, you know.
I saw that one, yeah.
And you motherfucker, you don't need a reality, so you need a reality check. Are you fucking crazy? It's just, and that's the thing people watch.
Right, yeah.
That's what they you know, they'll put a bunch of those shows on. Like, I dig Tyler Perry. I think he's talented.
Mm-hmm.
But if you put Tyler Perry and Amos and Andy and you ran them together, you couldn't tell the difference. But yeah. One is vilified and one is glorified.
Right, right. Yes.
So it's perception. It's not.
Because it is, you know, just the buffoonery.
It is.
And
but one was, okay, now one group, like Amos and Andy did it because that was all they were allowed to do
uh-huh.
at that particular, that was the only way that society would accept it. So they
right.
they said, we'll play along with it.
Just to get somewhere, yeah.
Just to get somewhere. And they were incredibly accomplished guys.
Right.
And then a group said, oh no, you're making us look bad.
Mm-hmm.
Don't do that anymore. Now, that same group says, you're doing a great job.
Yeah.
And here's this award.
Brilliant.
Wow.
Thank you. Yeah,
and
yeah.
It's really people's really dumbing down.
Yeah, that's the thing. They've dumbed down everything.
Everything.
And I think that does divide up the audience, that's for sure.
It is. I mean,
I don't think a lot of brothers are watching Big Bang Theory.
I've never watched one episode of Seinfeld.
Yeah. Seinfeld?
One.
Yeah. Yeah.
One. And I never.
Not, wow.
It's just not... Never once.
Sure. Yeah.
Not on purpose. Never went. Never said I'm gonna deliberately ignore this.
Right. It just not.
It just never happened.
Is that a popular show in Compton?
you know what? On the show, Steve, what is the what
Black
was my
and Black?
Fucking no Steve my fucking co-host.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah.
Steve Wilson.
Yeah.
He was talking about. He made a reference to Emo Phillips, and I'm like, I don't even know what the fuck that
God.
Is.
God.
Oh.
I have no.
Right.
Like, I didn't even know, like, I remember once we were doing Studio 60, and they were talking about Stairway to Heaven. I have to talk about it, and I'll say, oh, the OJ song. They're like, no, that's
oh,
like
no.
Led Zeppelin song.
The Led Zeppelin song.
Yes.
And I went, I've never fucking, I mean, I knew who he
is. He's the cool Bubba Ice of the white community.
Jesus.
He's the hamburger.
Yes.
I never got it,
yeah.
Quite frankly.
But I never had heard Stairway to Heaven. Never.
Wow.
And I'm talking about 2000... Six.
Everyone has heard Stairway by then.
Did you like
up
it?
To that
I
point.
Did.
Yeah.
I did like it. But I didn't, it was just.
That must be amazing to listen to Stairway and it's not an old played song.
Right.
It's like, wow, this is some good new
and
shit.
And I never, there are things, and I read a lot, I travel a lot. It's
mm-hmm.
just, in 2006, I hadn't heard probably one of the greatest, you know, most.
Right, right.
you know, albums of in history, and I didn't fucking hear it.
40 years later.
Right. Yeah, this is great. Have you heard this new shit?
This is great
stuff.
By this
new group called Led Zeppelin.
Fuck, Led Zeppelin.
Right.
I hope they tour.
I got desperately.
Oh, you got to take a leak? Yeah, all right, we'll take a little break. I know we have, well, DL's in studio right now.
Promoting. Let me give a proper plug for DL. It's a new show he's doing with Michael Ian Black, who's also very, very funny. It's called Trust Me, I'm a Game Show Host, and the premiere is tonight. It's October 22nd. It's 10:30. It's on TBS, so whatever your local... They'll find TBS. It's everywhere.
Yeah.
And it's right before Conan, so, you know, that's a good time. DL's on Twitter. Real DL Hughley, one word, and there's an... It's Hughley on Twitter,
mm-hmm.
and you can get all the deals, dates, and all that stuff.
Yeah,
so good
Jim,
luck.
Great.
It's half of you now.
What?
It's only half of you here now.
Yep, yeah. Well, thank God the good half stayed. that's my good nature.
Yuck.
That's the new good nature Jim. Now, you know, all the bad stuff, all the negativity.
The Jim low cholesterol.
Yeah.
Gluten-free.
Yeah, yeah. Jim's 45 and trying to get a TV deal, so it's about being fun and good for all now. You know?
Isn't that the fucking truth? Isn't that the truth?
Yeah.
I guess John Lithgow checked in downstairs, so John Lithgow's
next.
Coming.
Oh, wow.
In next. Yeah, you want to hang out. Fucking, you know, slide over one seat like the old Carson show.
This is 40. He was fucking hysterical.
Yeah. 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 He's apparently has a
children's
kids book. I don't know. Interesting. Hmm. We'll talk to him about that.
How about this? Don't touch that dial.
Ah, it's a good one, Jim. Bring in Mr.
John Lithgow is coming in.
Yes. This is a treat, Mr. Lithgow.
Oh.
Please take a seat. We are on the air.
Already?
As we speak.
How are you?
We like doing that.
How are you?
It eats up that awkward time when you're off the air, before you come on the air, when people sit down, you don't know anybody, and you're kind of,
yep.
So how's the weather? You know, it's pretty cold out. We could get right to the show this way.
That's fine.
I like it. I like it.
Hurl me into the deep end.
Yes.
I'm here.
What a treat having you. I mean, over the years, a huge fan. What a great resume you have in film, television, stage.
Yes.
Yes.
And now books.
And books now. I see this... nice, a cute little children's book,
mm-hmm.
apparently. I don't know what the title means. I hope you elaborate. Never play music right next to the zoo.
Yes. The book is, it's actually the narration for a musical suite that I and a composer named Bill Elliott cooked up a few years ago. It's just a simple children's story about a little boy who goes to a concert with his parents at a band show right next to the zoo. It's the performance piece, and there's a DVD, there's a CD of it with the book. The core is sort of verse chorus. It's spoken and sung, and the chorus is, "Oh, children, remember, whatever you may do, never play music right next to the zoo. They'll burst from their cages, each beast and each bird, desperate to play all the music they've heard," etc.
That sounds dangerous.
Animals crash out of their cages and take over the orchestra.
Oh!
And when I perform it with an orchestra, you have to instruct the instruments, the musicians, to play their instruments worse and worse as it goes on.
Oh, because obviously the animals...
They attempt to play.
They try.
Yeah, animals are terrible musicians.
That's true. I see on the cover right here, one of the elephants is trying to grab the bow from the cellist.
That's right. It's... I would love to read it to children over the radio, but it doesn't have the same impact.
Oh, that's
actually
be,
looking at the pictures and
right.
Yes, well, you could do it like Fiorello LaGuardia read the funny papers.
That's right.
You could describe the pictures.
But it's Lisa Hernandez illustrated it. It's just a wonderful book, and it's especially wonderful when I perform it with the orchestra.
Yeah.
But you don't need a full orchestra at bedtime.
What inspired you to do a children's book?
Well, this is actually my ninth. I've been doing them for years.
I'm out of the loop.
Here, look at the back.
Well, I told you that before the show.
Jimmy, no, you didn't.
Those are all the others.
Oh, my God, you are.
So this is my shadow career, you see.
Jeez.
I've been flying under the radar for years. The only people who know about it are little children and parents.
That must be it, because I am childless.
Yeah.
My really? Womb my yes. womb is barren. I have no children.
And, you know, as of age 8 or 9, children have outgrown me.
Yes.
So.
Yes.
So why kids' book? Have you written another book, or is it all children's stuff?
Well, I wrote a memoir a couple of years ago. But basically, I've only had the courage to write children's books. You know, the children are far less critical of your literary technique.
Well, that's true. I can't imagine many hater tweets from little kids.
Yeah, if they don't like it, they just kind of throw it on the floor.
Yeah,
they never
yeah.
have to hear about it.
But, you know, all my books grew out of concerts for kids, because I've always done that ever since my own kids were small.
Mm-hmm.
And my oldest is 41 years old, so
wow.
I've been doing it all these years. And of my 9 books, like 3/4 of them are things that I actually perform in concert, the lyrics to songs or the narration to A Child's Guide to the Orchestra Suites. I even wrote the narration for a ballet, for the New York City Ballet of Carnival of the Animals, the Saint-Saëns piece.
You are multifaceted.
Were you a musician before you acted, or were you acted before music?
I beg pardon?
You play music.
I play mediocre guitar, but I learned guitar just to play for kids. And I don't do it as often as I would like to, but concerts for children are completely fantastic.
Yeah,
I mean, they're an amazing audience, mainly because they're such a difficult audience, but if you can keep their attention.
Yeah
you know, we actors are all, we're all after the suspension of disbelief, and you never quite achieve that with grown-ups. They know you're pretending, but kids, you can sucker them into almost anything.
Have you had any bad shows with children? Have you?
Early on, I mean, it's a particular skill that you learn never to let them near your shoelaces, for example.
Oh, right.
They're sure to untie your shoelaces, and that becomes the big event.
They ignore your music.
No, but I mean, shoes. But I've done kids' concerts at Carnegie Hall for 2,500 kids.
Wow. And
at a certain point, you learn how to manage them.
Right.
And it's incredibly fun.
So
anyway, as I say, like you, I mean, most people don't know I do this, but
yeah, exactly. You know, obviously your acting career is at the forefront. That's what everybody knows.
That's my day job.
Your day job.
We realize we've been saying your name wrong for 25 years.
Well, the world seems to have.
Yes, yeah. I gave up correcting people a long time ago.
Yeah. Well, they've said Lithgow forever, and it's Lithgow.
Well, I pronounce it Lithgow. Apparently, I'm the only one.
Yeah.
I understand that Rachel Maddow has the same problem.
Oh, Maddow.
Everybody calls her Rachel Maddow.
Well, amongst other things.
Yes, exactly. But I have a new kinship with her.
Oh, yeah?
Really, are you kidding, or is that really her name? Rachel Maddow.
She pronounces it Maddow.
Maddow.
I heard her correct the world on television.
Commiserate.
And it's exactly what I go through, but it doesn't bother me. As long as they're pronouncing it, let them mispronounce it.
Yes, as long as they're reading it on a credit of a hit movie, as they say.
Do you like playing it seems like it's more fun to play like a shitty person than a good person.
Well, it's nice to surprise people. You know, that was the great thing about playing the Trinity Killer on Dexter, is to play him as a nice man with a secret. And to be known as kind of a sort of loopy, ineffectual fool like Dick Solomon, and then play the Trinity Killer, you just have the opportunity to completely shock people.
Yeah. It was a pretty dastardly character.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But great fun. You're right. It is fun.
Yeah, it seems like who wants to play a nice guy when you can play a psychopath? That just seems like you play a really great villain. I mean, and that's kind of what I would associate you with.
Yeah, if you're going to be in Othello, you want to play Iago.
And now the dummies in this room will all act like we know who those characters are.
Yes.
But we really are all high school dropout fools.
Yes, indeed.
I have no idea. We just know Othello is very popular.
Well, Iago's the great role.
Why is Iago? What did Iago do in Othello?
Iago is the arch villain. He's the one who destroys Iago.
Of course, Jim.
Othello.
And, please.
Yeah.
But he has this incredible connection with the audience. He tells everybody what he's doing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Cool.
So just listen to your partner.
He's right. And he thinks that Othello is a board game.
Yes. Well, it's that, too.
Yes.
Do you do good Shakespeare? Shakespeare seems impossible.
Well, it's not easy. I grew up, my father was a theater producer who created Shakespeare festivals. I sort of grew up, I was in like 20 Shakespeare plays before I was 20 years old. So wow. It's a kind of language that I grew up with, but it's a challenge. And it's at the very heart of British theater. And, I mean, Shakespeare is certainly popular in American theater too, but it's the very spine of a British actor's training. And it really is, you do have to learn how to perform it.
You know, seem when I watch guys doing it, it just seems like the British actors that I've seen doing it seem too proper, and it doesn't seem like this, it means anything. And I said, you know, I've talked about Brando doing it. I watched him do it, and it was like, that's a guy who really seems to understand what it is he's saying.
Absolutely. I mean, there have been brilliant American productions of Shakespeare. This past summer in Central Park, I saw this production of Comedy of Errors, of all things, set in upstate New York in the 1930s. And the characters were all reimagined as the mafia up in so the Duke of... Yeah. And they even used all the sort of classic Greco-Roman place names in upstate New York, like Troy, New York, and Ithaca, New York, and Rome, New York. And it was played like The Sopranos, and it was hilariously funny, and this the music of the language was completely different. It was very American. It's
amazing how that could be translated.
Shakespeare's flexible.
You can put it in a whole different setting and keep the storyline, and it actually works.
Yeah, they did Much Ado About Nothing years ago in the park, set in Teddy Roosevelt's sort of Midwestern America. With soldiers coming home from the Spanish-American War. And again, it was just, you just heard it in a completely different way. Basically, Shakespeare is a great storyteller, and you have to get beyond the fact that you're really learning a new language. It's like 450-year-old language.
Yeah, you can't just repeat what you read and memorize the words. You have to know what they mean in order to convey it properly, I would imagine. You can't just blurt it out.
Actually, there's a wonderful new book written by the playwright Ken Ludwig, which is called How to Teach Your Children Shakespeare. And it's...
What is that, to punish him?
He asked me to write the introduction, which I did. It's a wonderful book, and it's a book... adults can enjoy it so much too, because it just gets at just the fun of Shakespeare, the fun of learning it and knowing it.
How many awards have you won?
Oh, well, a lot.
Yeah,
a lot of awards. But I'll tell you one thing: I've won a lot more nominations than actual awards.
And this might be a hard question, but like, I'm always, when somebody wins something and they're up against competition that's very impressive, is there one person that you've beaten that you were the most impressed that you beat, because they're, which is kind of a sign of respect for them, like, I can't believe I beat this person.
Well, it's always a great gang of actors. Let's see, who were the...
Rob Schneider?
I tend to forget them as soon as it's done.
that's somebody who's truly won a lot of awards.
Yes, right.
I won a comedy competition in 1993. I won a trophy for Black History Month.
Wow.
I did. It was only four of us as comedians, and I was terrible, but I was less terrible.
Uh-huh.
And I still have that trophy.
And you remember who you beat?
I do.
Yeah, I mean, we're all suckers for awards. It's a nice thing when it happens, and it's far too important when you don't lose. You get into a terrible funk.
Really?
Sulk about it.
When you don't lose?
Huh?
You mean when you don't win?
Yeah.
When you don't lose.
Oh, yeah. What do you seem like you're busy all the time. You're working. Do you get a chance to relax? What do you like to do when you're just doing nothing?
Well, I'm a huge sports fan. I can sit hours and hours. I can't wait for this World Series.
Oh, okay.
And I have a sort of discarded ambition. I wanted to be a painter when I was young, and I'm actually still a sort of hobbyist as a painter.
Yeah, set the old easel up and
I
take a stab at it.
I even had a studio in
California, but until they tore the building down.
What do you paint?
I paint figuratively, portraits, and I work in oils, and I work, but I mean, I sort of live out the fantasy of having become an artist. I'm not an artist. I don't even pretend I am. I have too much respect for great artists to put me in their company. But it is an amazing activity to just sort of lose yourself in a painting. 4 hours can go by and you're just, you don't remember a single conscious thought you had. You've just been completely immersed in that activity. I tell you, my favorite thing is something that demands great concentration but no thought. That's, to me, that's great relaxation.
Now, Harry and the Hendersons.
Oh.
We all wanted to talk about that.
Absolutely.
Why no more of them?
Why no more of them?
Yeah.
Well, I don't know. It's, you know, it was not actually that successful a film when it was released. Amazingly, you'd be amazed, because I mean, I wish I had a nickel for every adult who said they grew up on
Harry
and the Hendersons.
Yeah.
But it, you know, you have to be a big success to get a sequel, because it all happens within, it has to happen almost immediately, putting another one into motion.
Right.
It was, they did make a sitcom out of it.
Yeah.
But it was a Saturday morning, most people don't even know what ever happened.
Right, right. Yeah.
And I was not in that.
No. You were in a very successful sitcom there, Third Rock.
Oh, yes.
Yes. He's got to remember that. It's like, it was a hugely successful multi-year.
Yes, although these days everybody tells me how much they love me on 30 Rock.
Oh, see, that's, that's different.
It's a semantic thing.
Do you correct them or just kind of just silently hate them?
I just thank them. I also thank them when they tell me how much they liked me on Monty Python.
Oh, no. Do you get mistaken for John Cleese?
Yes.
Wow.
Even called John Cleese.
And
he's a friend of mine. I've never actually asked him whether anyone mistakes him for John Lithgow.
Well, probably John Lithgow.
Yes,
that's
exactly.
The thing.
Do you sell your paintings?
No.
See, a lot of celebrities paint and then sell them. That's what you should do.
Like John Wayne Gacy?
Well, yeah.
I know.
Oh, God. It's terrible. No.
I know Pierce Brosnan paints and sells his paintings, but he sells it all for charity.
Oh, okay.
But no, I don't paint enough to. I hate to let them go. I give them away, but I don't sell them.
Can you paint hands? I could never draw hands. I really suck at hands.
Hands are a challenge. They will drive everybody crazy.
Yeah.
Jim's life in all arts would be so much better if hands didn't exist. He always says his problem in acting is that he doesn't know what to do with his hands.
I never know what to do with my hands in a scene. Like, I don't know where to put them to be natural.
It just seems awkward to leave them hanging.
That's why.
Or put them somewhere.
Pay attention to my acting. You'll see that I'm always messing with props.
Always have something in your hand.
Next time you watch a movie, you'll see
that
inevitably I'm doing something.
But I always give myself something unimportant, like a little business. I'm in a love scene. I'm holding a bedpan, and I'm just giving it back.
Exactly.
But you have to give yourself, I guess, something to do. But it's so awkward. Like, we're talking right now, my hands are on my lap,
and
they're not moving, and it's comfortable.
Naturally.
Yeah.
But if we were in a scene right now, I would
think something was wrong.
I'd have bowling balls in my hand. I would feel awful sitting like this in a scene.
Well,
acting is a funny thing. It's, you can be so, even me, and I've done a lot of acting in my life, you're capable of feeling incredibly self-conscious and uncomfortable until it feels right, and you somehow, over time, you just figure out how to keep working at something.
Everyone is an amazing actor when they're not acting.
Yeah.
It's the simplest thing to carry on a natural conversation with somebody and look authentic, because it is. But then trying to recreate it, which seems bizarre, that you need to be very talented to recreate something you just do every second of your life.
Yeah. It's very interesting, and ask any actor. They always feel that they act better off camera for somebody else. They'll do their close-up, then switch around to allow someone else to do his close-up.
And that's
and
the
off,
take. That
off camera, you suddenly feel so real and so relaxed and so witty. It's just, and you think, damn, the camera's not on me.
Can you use the back of my head on this one? Yeah, it's brilliant.
Yeah.
Yeah, wow, that's...
I never know. It's the hard part is also there's a part of me that just goes, you're faking it. And you're not supposed to think that while you're acting. You're faking this.
You know who's an amazing director in exactly this area is Judd Apatow.
Oh, wow.
I worked with him on This Is 40 last year.
Right.
For the first time. And he just sets up the cameras and lets them roll for 15 minutes. And you just do the scene again and again with him throwing new lines, new ideas. You're fully expected at a certain point to start improvising.
Mm.
And he works with a bunch of actors who work with him all the time and
right.
are very familiar and easy with this technique. And he gets the most spontaneous. That's why his comedies have such freshness.
That seems to be an amazing technique, because you would kind of fall into a rhythm doing it enough times without having that, all right, do it again yeah. kind of a thing.
Yeah.
In
fact, he'll say, now just go and do it again and just try something completely different. And this without ever saying cut.
Mm.
You know, he'll get 15 minutes of material.
What a lazy director.
Yeah, exactly. He's in the truck. He's eating.
Yes, he slouches all the way to the bank.
Now, you've directed, right?
I actually started out as a theater director.
Oh, okay.
But only because I couldn't get any acting work. Mm. As soon as I got moving as an actor, I sort of left directing behind.
Yeah. Did you direct any episodes of Third Rock?
No, I never.
Oh, you didn't? Because usually,
wanted to.
After a while.
You know, we had this wonderful director, Terry Hughes. Third Rock was just a terrific. It's always almost the factory system. Everybody knew his role, and just I was just not interested in taking the helm.
It's having
too much fun acting.
Yeah, I always found that weird, because acting and directing aren't really that similar.
No,
but a lot of actors want to go into directing.
There was a period when I was both acting and directing in theater. And I found it very, very hard to cross back and forth across the line.
Yeah.
It's just a completely different relationship with your colleagues, one thing. And you're somehow, you can't monitor yourself. I feel I always need someone to tell me, even if I don't buy what they're saying, I want somebody else to be monitoring what I do.
Right, right. You'd be the boss.
Yeah.
How was Shatner to work with on Third Rock?
Bill is great. I mean, when he did the big giant head on Third Rock.
Yeah, yeah.
As far as I know, it was his first flat-out piece of comedy.
Mm.
And look at what's happened
since.
He just, he so enjoyed that.
Yeah.
And it was like red meat to a tiger. He just, it was like a great relief to him to make a fool of him.
He is a lot of fun. He's a
Have you interviewed him?
We've had him on a lot. He was just here last week.
Yeah.
He's one of those guys that just works relentlessly.
Yeah.
And
he so enjoys it.
He loves
it. Line ads. You just see that he's having such a good time.
Yeah, yeah. We had him on. I like to torture him with nothing but Star Trek references.
Yeah.
And actually the common bond you two have is
the Twilight Zone
episode. With a nightmare at I guess it was 30,000 feet, and his was 20,000 feet. So
as a matter of fact, when he was on Third Rock, his first entrance was we met him as he got off a plane.
Oh, right.
And he said, oh my god, it was horrible.
Yes.
This is a man on the wing of that plane. And my line was, the same thing happened to me. You know,
that's brilliant.
We could do anything on Third Rock.
Oh, that's funny.
What did we ask him about that? There was something we asked him about.
You asked him about the guy in the suit. And he said he was a small Czechoslovakian fellow.
Oh, right. I asked him to talk to him at craft services.
All Jim wanted to know was who was the guy in the dumb furry suit.
Yeah. In our case, it was a very good actor named Larry Cedar.
Mm.
So nice to be able to give him a shout-out after all these years.
Right?
Yep.
That was a scary costume.
He was brilliant.
That was a good one. Not like the little furry suit from the episode. Did you borrow anything from Shatner in that?
No, I didn't see the episode.
Oh, wow.
Until years later. I finally just saw it by chance on a Twilight Zone marathon.
Yeah, yeah. Wow, that's amazing. I would assume...
No, I'd never seen it. And it never sort of registered when I was a kid, even though I remember seeing lots of Twilight Zone.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
But, so how did you take it when you we were discussing what that was supposed to mean? How did you take it that you, that what that was trying to say?
We sort of George Miller directed that episode, and we actually made a conscious choice to make it a film about fear of flying, just pure terror.
Mm.
And of course the wonderful twist at the end when it actually happened is what,
yeah.
what turned it into a Twilight Zone episode. But as a matter of fact, I talked to a great old friend of mine whom I knew had terrible, terrible fear of flying, just to ask him specifics. And I was amazed at the things he told me.
Yeah.
He was very open about it. Just to give you one example, he said when he's on an airplane and he walks down the aisle when it's in flight, he's terrified of putting too much weight on one side or the other for fear he's going to upend the plane.
Is he fat? Right, right.
And he knows it's completely irrational,
uh-huh.
but it doesn't. And if you watch that film, you'll see just the way I used that was walking down that aisle as if I was on a tightrope.
Yeah, yeah.
Absolutely terrified that the plane was going to tip over. And this was one of 20 extraordinary things he told me that were so easy to use.
Has he ever gotten over his fear of flying? Because that fear of flying is a bitch.
I think he must still have it.
It's so restrictive to people, yeah.
But he said when the phone rings in his house, he immediately panics because he's afraid it's his agent telling him he has a job that will require him to fly.
Wow, that's a fear of flying.
Now that, but I mean, you notice how insane my performance was?
Oh, yes.
Well, it's I used it all.
Tell your friends to hire my manager. That call will never come. I'll never have to.
The sound in that too. The lightning in the window, and then the engines changing their tone was frightening.
That's like George.
That whole thing was an amazing.
George Miller. He did that one just after he'd done the Mad Max movies. I mean that.
Oh right.
High octane filmmaking.
Sure.
And it was all, you know, it was nothing CGI about it. We had a real wing of a plane on hydraulics. We had like five gigantic wind machines blowing smoke. And he undercranked it so that everything was sped up.
A little faster,
including the movements of the little gremlin.
Yeah, yeah.
The gremlin was on wires so he could hop up and down.
I asked William Shatner about... So why didn't he just tell his damn wife, sit by this window, look at, if you want to help me, I know this is it's going to be a terrible flight for you, but just look out the window the entire time.
Yes.
Never look away, and either she's going to see it, or everything will be fine.
Yeah.
Well, we deleted the wife, you'll recall.
Yes, yes, you did.
Just so you wouldn't be asking that question.
Right, right.
Then again, the gremlin would have just switched wings.
I know, that's true.
I mean, some guy
on the other side of the plane would have.
But, you know,
experience.
Now, never play music right next to the zoo.
Ah, that's true. Yes.
Yes, that's what we're hearing about.
Back to the book.
But it also, this is, I can actually make you a segue.
Nice.
It's about a little boy who falls asleep and dreams all this. So it's a dreamlike kind of exciting and terrifying dream for children that has a happy ending.
And there are signings, too, I want to promote because these are always good. For a book, you can go down and meet John and get your book signed tomorrow at Bookends in East Ridgewood. I'm in Ridgewood, New Jersey, on East Ridgewood Avenue. That's a great independent bookstore in New Jersey at 4:30. So get there early. There will be a line, but you can line up inside. It's a really huge bookstore where they do the signings in the basement, so it's great. You're not going to be stuck outside. And the 25th, which is, I think, Friday?
Friday, yes.
The 7 o'clock, the book review. It's in Huntington, New York, on New York Avenue, which is not too far from F.H. Riley's, I don't think, right?
I used to live right around there, on Long Island.
Well, I expect you guys to be there.
Absolutely. I'll be there, Mr. Lithgow.
And I think I'm even going to perform it, so.
Oh, man.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. I'm doing this sort of karaoke version. Bill Elliott sent me the entire score without the voice, so I'm going to put it into a boombox and perform it for the kids. Because the whole fun of it is hearing an orchestra play badly.
Yeah. Well, this is great. What a treat. Yeah. Thanks so much for coming in.
Great.
And continued success with your children's books that I didn't even have a clue. I feel ass.
But you're not a child. You only behave like
I've been told differently, yes. But, wow, you got quite the collection here.
Yeah, it's, and they're wonderful books too. They're Simon and Schuster books that I started writing them in like 1999, and I produced them.
Make a good Christmas gift.
That's why I'm here. Why do you think I'm here?
Of course. Very good. John Lithgow.
Lithgow. And I didn't even get a chance to just say how you don't understand how you changed my life after the world according to Garp.
as long as it was just your life.
The direction my life went into it after that movie.
Oh, yes.
Thank you.
Jimmy.
You're a great actor, and thank you for coming.
Well, thank you. Yes. It's really a pleasure. You guys are great.
And I guess, Sam Roberts, you'll be up next with the after show.
That's exactly right.
Who you got on there?
Justin Long is actually coming in today.
Is he on drugs?
Like hopefully.
Yesterday's guest. Crossed.
Yesterday was a big success. So.
Yeah. All right. And, of course, thank everybody, E-Rock and Travis and everything. And I guess, I know it's
if we're not
early,
dead, we'll be here tomorrow.
Yeah, don't worry about it.
Well, I wish I were.
Yeah, oh boy.
You're dead?
No. I wish I were going to be here tomorrow.
What a sad way to end this fun interview. Jeez.
After this
that
interview.
Was either a very good or a very bad review of your show.